Well, hey, y'all. Hey, welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all do me a favor and please love up on Love Jones for me. And please make sure that you've liked the video on your way in and don't be afraid to drop in the chat box and say hello. If you enjoy yourself while you're here, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click the notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the speakeasy is open for business. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my wonderful returning sippers and speakers, better known as the Speakeasy Backyard Gang, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thank you for coming back one more time to love up on your girl, because I am addicted to the way that y'all love up on me. All right, so listen, honey. We are starting a new book today. I hope y'all are feeling good. Y'all listen. I had a little skippity pap of a nap. Shut up, Love Jones. I don't want to hear about it. So I laid down at about 8:41 this morning to go sleepy night-night. And I had planned on getting up at like 2:30. But no, had to get back up at 11:15 because... child, niggas be niggering, and so just so what you gonna do? Anyway, I had to get my ass up. So anyway, I'm but I feel good though. I'm like a little baby, you know. I took a little nap and now I'm woke, so let's play. All right. Oh my God, I either feel really good or I'm fucking delirious. I'm gonna let y'all decide. Either way, I feel good though. So, hey, that's what we're gonna run with. Hey, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Tanisha's first sipper and speaker in the building. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Hey, Nora and Marva. Hey, y'all. Hey. Oh, I'm glad y'all are here. Hey, Naja, Seti said is in the building. She said, I'm getting my ass in here early today, damn it. Hey, girl, hey. Hey, Demisha. Ooh, child, did you get your rump over there and take a little look-see at what you needed to look-see at? Did you do a little looking and a little seeing? Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, child. I'm going to see. That lets me know how much attention y'all pay to my community tab. So we gonna see, child. All right, I'm scrolling. Hey, Tiffany, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. And you too, Angel. Yes, it does look like a good read, doesn't it? Yes, indeed. All right, let me see. I'm scrolling. Hey, Shakayla, welcome, welcome. Destiny Bella is in the building. Naomi Caroline is here. Hey, girl. Hey. Let me see. I'm scared. Hold on. This thing done jumped up. Now, listen, y'all. Damn, StreamYard is tripping because they had a problem. Child, folks couldn't even go live earlier today. So now it's just done jumped up a whole bunch. Child, let me... annoyed already. Let me scroll back up. Okay. Shanae is here. Hey, girl. Hey. All right, here we go. Let me see. I got Shakayla. I'm sorry, y'all, but I don't want to be rude. Make sure I didn't miss nobody, child. Okay, Andy's in the building. Hey, girl. Hey, I got Naomi, right? Hey, hey. Jasmine is here. Hey, hey. I'm going to slow down a little bit. Yes, you did, Marva. Yes, you did. You made it. Hey, Kay, welcome. And Nice and Thick is in the building. Hey, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Hey, D. Reed and Sherelle and Candace Lott and Kayla's back in the building with us. And Shamikia came right behind her. And Cupcake is here. Hey, y'all. Hey. All right. Let me see. Who else? I'm going. Uh-oh. It jumped again. Oh, shit. This is going to be a problem. Hey, Nakia. Welcome. Welcome, darling. And no, ma'am. Mm-mm. No teenagers. She said he free and can feed himself. Is he working, though? That's the question. Hey, little mama. I'm afraid you stuck with him, baby girl. All right. Thank you for being here, little mama. I appreciate you. And you too, April Showers. Yes. Hey, girl. Hey, yes. All right. Let me see. Hey, November. Welcome. Welcome. Buck, who likes to fuck and can play a mean organ. Welcome. Thank you for being here, young man. I appreciate you. Hey, Jewel Cray. Welcome. Welcome. Chelsea Brown is in the building. Child, I don't think I've ever seen you here before. Y'all welcome Chelsea to the Speakeasy. Welcome, darling. And hey, Nye. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. All right, so I think I got everybody. So let me do oh Lord. All right, y'all gonna have to wait until I finish up, child. Hold on.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Thank you, Summer, for the pre-show tip. She said, thanks, Saki. She was on the replay, so that's a replay tip. Thank you, Summer, and you're welcome. All right.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
And that was for Miss Pretty. Thank you for the tip. And she said, for Lost in the Den. Now I'm hungry. Child, it'll make you hungry. Quit playing. Anyway, that was a TMI. Sorry about that. Anyway, no, I'm not sorry about it. It is what it is. But yes, the den was absolutely. I'm going to build a place like that. I'm speaking it into the universe, child. Listen, fuck what you heard. All right. So y'all know we're starting a new book today. Girl, keep your damn baby. He gonna grow up and be a big old basketball star or a major fucking architect, and you gonna be mad because you done gave his ass away. Mm-mm. All right, so here we go. I got my time stamp, and we just gotta wait and let it count down. Y'all better quit giving y'all babies away. Mm-mm. Keep that baby. Yep, just grab you a skillet. That's all you gotta do. That's how you get them in line, child. Mm-mm-mm. Today, we're reading The Maintenance Man by Tanisha Stewart, and the synopsis reads, Mama said don't play with fire because one day you might get burned. Malachi is a self-proclaimed ladies' man. Others would describe him as a dog. He claims to be madly in love with his girlfriend Zoe, but can't seem to stop talking to other women. Everything appears to be going well for him until the bodies start dropping. Caught up in a race against time with too many suspects to figure out who's after him, it's time for Malachi to finally come clean. He wants to do the right thing, but his conscience is often clouded by bad decisions. Is there a chance for Malachi's redemption, or is he just biding his time until his number is called? Well, we about to find out. So listen, y'all. This is a little bit different from what we normally read. It was kind of, this puts me kind of in the mind of, remember the book that we read where we were trying to figure out, what was it? A Rich Man's Wife or The Rich Man's Wife, whichever one it is, shall pick. Okay. Don't matter. You know what I'm talking about. We read parts one and two. Remember we were trying to figure out who it was that, you know, was coming after her or whatever. I think that was the book, that this put me in the mind of. So it's a little bit different. Some of y'all might get with it. I don't think it's going to be a whole lot of, you know, skippity-papping in here. You know, we might get some kissing or something. I don't know. I can't tell you. But just get your popcorn because, you know, either way, we getting ready to get started. All right? All right. Chapter 1. Malachi often described himself as a ladies' man, but deep down inside, he knew he was a dog. He glanced to his left to see Zaire, one of his day ones, shuffle the deck of cards. Ben, his other boy, was seated to his right on the small circular table set up in Zaire's living room. This was the guy's favorite pastime, playing a few rounds of poker, betting on who would take home all the money, drinking a couple of beers, and listening to the game in the background, courtesy of Zaire's 96-inch flat screen. Zaire turned back to look at the TV as the men heard the crowd go wild. That's right, run that shit, Zaire screamed at his favorite player of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. He was sporting the team's jersey in honor of the game, hoping they made it to the Super Bowl this year. Malachi glanced at Ben and smirked, then took a sip of his Bud Light. Okay, I already don't like him. Why the fuck is you drinking Bud Light? All right, anyway, all right. He and Ben were Cowboys fans. Sorry, I don't know which is worse, that he drink Bud Light or that. Anyway, they just suck this year. Well, last season. You know what I'm talking about. Their team was playing next week, but tonight they would roast Zaire endlessly if the Bucks lost. Come on, man, Malachi urged, goading Zaire. You know they ain't taking the win tonight. Pay attention to the matter at hand. I'm trying to make this money. Zaire turned his attention back to the table after the ball was intercepted by the opposing team and finished shuffling the cards. Then he had Ben cut the deck and reshuffled before passing them out. Let's see what you got this round, trash man, he said to Malachi. Malachi let out a chuckle. Forget you. I am a sanitation engineer, senior level to be exact. Better put some respect on my shit. Listen, that's right. You better take pride in that damn good county job. Shit, I ain't mad at you. It's either the county, the city, or the village. I don't give a fuck what you call it. That's a good job, got good benefits, and you get a good little salary, child. Anyway, stick with it. Ben and Zaire both laughed at that one, each studying their hands. They often got on Malachi, calling him a trash man, because his salary was higher than both of theirs, despite what he did for a living. See, I just fucking said it. I'm trying to tell you, don't be skipping on them on them streets and sanitation workers. Hell, they be making a cute little coin. All right, here we go. Zaire was a public school teacher and Ben was a firefighter. Yeah, two broke ass motherfuckers talking shit to the trash man. A text buzzed on Malachi's phone, which was in the pocket of his jeans. He pulled it halfway out to look at the screen. Working late tonight. See you later, babe. He sucked his teeth at his girlfriend's message, but on the inside, he was partially relieved. What's up? Ben asked. Zoe's working overnight, Malachi replied. Guess I need a plan B. Plan B? Ben inquired, his brow slightly raised. Another one of his bitches, Zaire said. Malachi didn't deny it, so Ben sighed. Malachi, Zoe's gonna kill your ass if she ever finds out. Why you always on his back? Zaire asked. It's not his fault she's too blind to see he ain't shit. Malachi was with Zaire till that last part. Fuck you, man. He chuckled, pushing Zaire's shoulder. Ben still looked upset. I'm saying, old man, hasn't it ever crossed your mind that we're getting too old for that? We, Zaire repeated. Since when did you ever pull more than one bitch at once? Figure a speech, nigga, Ben said a little too aggressively. So that's the answer, never. Anyway, which let Malachi know he was upset about something other than his infidelities. What's good with you? Malachi asked. Ben calmed down. Nothing, man. Sabrina flaked out on me. Sabrina was a woman Ben had been talking to for months, but she had yet to accept his request to make things official. Ben's situation with Sabrina was one of the reasons Malachi had reservations about buckling down and finally doing right by Zoe, despite the fact that he planned to propose to her soon. The saying that nice guys finish last was the story of Ben's life. The females were steady playing him and dissing him because he was too nice. Malachi and Zaire often tried to give him advice, but he always turned them down, saying he was adamant about his convictions. What'd she do? Zaire asked. Stood me up again. Ben stared straight ahead as he spoke. She needs to hurry up and get over her ex. I don't know how much longer I can do this, Zaire snorted. You sure she ain't still under that nigga? Ben glared at Zaire. Oh, what are you talking about? Zaire sat back in his seat. Nothing, man. I'm just saying. The streets is talking. And saying what? Ben's eyes narrowed even further. Zaire's just fucking with you, Malachi said, to draw their attention back to the game. He knew it would hurt Ben to hear the rumors about Sabrina sneaking around with her ex, and he didn't feel like hearing that shit tonight. His mind was on where he was going after he won this money. Come on, let's end this. I gotta head out. Zaire wasn't ready to back down from Ben yet. You haven't given that bitch any more money, have you? Malachi took one look at Ben and knew Zaire asked a horrible question. To be the smartest man Malachi knew, Ben was dumb as fuck. He'd recently confessed to giving Sabrina over $500 the last time she stood him up, allegedly to get her hair and nails done. Where the fuck she going to get her hair and nails done? Does it cost $500 to do that? Is that including buying the little wig from the beauty supply store, wherever the fuck you get them from, Amazon or wherever? Is that all $500 for somebody to put it on? Or can't you put it on at home? Why is it so damn expensive? $500? Shit. All right, sorry. When she didn't show up for their date, Ben was heated. He gave her $500 to get all that done and then she didn't show up. Oh my God. Okay. To say the least, but to make matters worse, that was when the rumor started that she'd actually used the money to get dolled up for a date with her ex, Braden. Well, how bad could he be? His fucking name is Braden. Sorry. Malachi could see Ben growing upset, so he redirected the conversation again. Chill, Zaire. Like I said, I got somewhere to be after this. He added a smirk for good measure after his statement, and thankfully it drew Zaire's attention away from keeping Ben in the hot seat. Zaire looked at Malachi with intrigue. You already made plans with another bitch in a span of 5 minutes? Damn, nigga. Zaire threw his hand down. Pay up, fellas. He had thrown out a full house. Malachi could see why he thought he won the game. Whatever, Ben said, throwing out his hand. He had a shitty deal. Zaire reached toward the chips and the money, which was $600. Each player had put down $200 and decided that the winner would take all. Not so fast, Malachi said, and threw down his hand, which was five of a kind. Motherfucker, Zaire said, while Ben looked disinterested. Malachi took the money, talked a little more trash to Zaire and Ben, then headed to his destination. On his way there, feelings of guilt crept into his heart, but he pushed them back. No time to be guilty now, especially since I already texted her and said he was on his way. Yes, he loved Zoe, but sometimes Malachi felt that he loved Aaron more. She was the one who got away. It was Malachi's fault, of course, for doing the same thing to Aaron that he was currently doing to Zoe. Malachi paused at a stop sign and thought about his life and his actions up to this point. Maybe Ben was right. Despite the fact that his best friend seemed to have horrible luck with women, he did have a point about integrity. Malachi had never been in a relationship where he hadn't cheated, aside from one. Yet he always envisioned himself in the future as a one-woman man with two kids and a beautiful wife he could shower with love and affection. He smiled at the thought. Then it erased when he remembered his reality. He had a son, Makai, but his relationship with Makai's mother, Shartasia. What in the whole fuck? S-H-A-R-T-A-Y-S-I-A, Shartasia, was far from the American dream. She was what Malachi described as batshit crazy, yet he couldn't seem to fully let go of her. They weren't messing around a lot, but they did still sleep together from time to time, and Shartasia often hinted she wanted them to get back together. And once again, that's the reason why both sexes think that their currents are still fucking around with their exes if they got kids. So yeah, it's a little bit more than co-parenting. So what is it called? Co-parenting with coitus? You know, like, get the fuck out of here. No, sir. Anyway, Malachi had decided when they broke up for good that they would, that would never happen again, though. Despite their 9-year-old son, Shartasia had run him down with her car before breaking up with him when she found out he cheated years ago. If he slipped up again, he couldn't afford to have her slit his throat in his sleep or something. Wait, what? What the hell does that have to do with it? He talking about Shartasia. That was a baby mama. Well, who cares? Maybe she done forgot already. Okay, a horn sounded behind Malachi, shaking him out of his thoughts. He took his turn toward Aaron's house. He would think more about his future later. For now, it was time to end the night off right. Okay, and that's the end of that chapter. I don't know, starting off a little slow. You know, got to give him a little time. You know what I'm saying? He's a grower and not a shower. So, yes. Yes, indeed. Cast iron, Nakia. Yes. Ring his bell. Hey, Shakara. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Let me see. Hey, Missouri. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Nico. Welcome. Thank you for being here as well. You guys, please do me a favor. I would like to ask you to keep sweet coconut in your prayers, please. Just pray for her. Okay, just put up a prayer for health, wealth, and happiness. All right. Thank you. All right. Hey, Fancy Danny, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. All right. You just missed the first chapter, child, and a little bit of shit talking. So you can reball it back, listen to it at double speed, and then you'll be all caught up in no time. All right, let me see. So I got my timestamp, y'all. Just got to let it count on down. Lord, have mercy. Y'all, coffee is so delicious and nutritious. I don't know if it's nutritious, but I do know it's delicious. Oh, my God. I don't think it's nutritious, though, but who gives a fuck? It's good. Chapter 2. Malachi spotted Aaron peeking out at his approaching vehicle through the blinds in her living room as he circled around to the back of her house. I'm laughing because I thought about something in my head like, shit, don't worry about it. Y'all still fucking sucking dick and that ain't nutritious. Anyways, oh Lord. Hey, Sydney, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Oh Lord, have mercy. All right, let me shut up and get back to it. All right, she had it bad for him, and he felt the same toward her, which was why he never could walk away. He clicked his fob after exiting his Ford Taurus. This nigga drives a Ford Taurus, and you cheating in a Taurus. Sir, how you cheat on somebody and you drive a Ford Taurus? Oh my God, I don't even like, I don't know what's next, a Dodge Neon? I don't know, like, how do you cheat and drive a Taurus? That's like, anyway. Already feeling his heart leap with excitement as he strode toward her sliding glass back door. Aaron always left it open for him. If only one day he could be entering through the front door rather than the back. Unfortunately, things were much too complicated for that. Malachi's complications included his soon-to-be fiance, Zoe, while Aaron's consisted of her fear of trusting him again, for obvious reasons, as well as the tiny matter of her being in a full-blown relationship with her drug dealer boyfriend, Banks, spelled B-A-N-K-Z. I guess that's his way of trying to say he got a whole lot of money. Well, his wallet must be bigger than his pistol because she fucking this nigga who drives a Ford Taurus. No time to think about that now. Malachi's face broke out in a grin as soon as he saw the way Aaron's eyes lit up at the sight of him. He quickly slid the door closed, then held his arms open as she rushed into his embrace. He inhaled the scent of her hair for a moment, and it brought a tear to his eye. He wished life didn't have to be the way it was, and he didn't have to do the things he did. You don't, his mind reminded him, but he ignored it. He'd been running around with different women for years. He simply didn't know how to stop. He had a sneaking suspicion that if Aaron gave him a second chance, though, but not Zoe. Malachi shivered as a chill went down his back. He almost pulled away from Aaron and told her he had to leave. Zoe was at the hospital, busting her ass on a double shift because they were saving for a down payment on a house. She was a damn good woman, and here Malachi was slapping her in the face by betraying her trust every chance he got. You can help it, but you won't. The realization hit him like a ton of bricks. What's wrong? Aaron said, noticing his pause. Malachi snapped out of it and looked down into her eyes. They were a soft brown color. They were part of the reason he fell in love with her in the first place, and also one of the reasons he found it hard to let go. Zoe felt like his future, but Aaron held his heart. Nothing, he said, and before he could utter another word, Aaron leaned up and pressed her lips against his. That's fuck. See how these niggas do you? Here you is out here fucking breaking your back, working double shifts at the hospital. Okay, not the hospital, because you know we don't say it like that. He in the hospital. So you over here busting your ass, double shifts at the hospital to get put a down payment on a crib with this raggedy ass Ford Taurus driving motherfucker. You know, like he pushing a nice whip. Whatever, sir. He outside spraying armor all on them Maypop ass tires. Boy, fuck you. Anyway, and he over here dicking down his ex. Are you serious right now, sir? You got a side bitch, a ex who you still fucking, and the girl who's busting her ass at the hospital. And you drive a fucking Taurus, sir. No, God. I hope everybody using condoms. Anyway, the warmth and softness he was welcomed with made Malachi weak in the knees. His manhood jumped in anticipation. As if she read his body, Aaron's hands traveled downward until she was holding him in her hand through his jeans. Attaboy, she remarked. She gave Malachi a dreamy gaze. How about we take this upstairs? Malachi wordlessly followed, and as soon as they crossed the threshold into the bedroom Aaron shared with Banks, it was on. Down went the robe Aaron had covering her toned but curvy body, and Malachi's mouth watered at the sight of her baby blue negligee. Shit, he breathed. Then he was on her like white on rice. He devoured her with his lips, their tongues dancing in harmony. She laced her fingers with his, and he held her hands for a few seconds as they sank deeper into their embrace. Then he couldn't hold himself back any longer. He found himself cupping her soft bottom, which to his delight was exposed since she was wearing a thong. Mmm, he murmured as Aaron's moans escalated. He went down to her neck as they traveled to the bed. He laid her down, then gently slipped her thong panties off. When he got them off, he held them up for a few moments, then gave Aaron a penetrating stare. She stared back with her own layers of intensity, then slowly pulled the negligee over her head, revealing her naked body underneath. Malachi swallowed, his Adam's apple bulging as his breathing became labored. He could taste her already. He dropped her thong to the floor, pulled his t-shirt over his own head, then stepped out of his jeans and Tim's. I'm sorry, that should have said Tim's and jeans. How the fuck did he step out of his jeans and Tim's? Anyway. Aaron stared at his midsection, then licked her lips. He missed me, didn't he? She asked. Malachi smiled at the devilish look in her eyes. Indeed, he did. Aaron stared for a few more seconds before she said, well, why don't you set him free? Malachi didn't need to be asked twice. His boxers were on the floor and he was on top of Aaron, crawling forward as she was inching back in a matter of seconds. Malachi let out a moan of his own. The skin-to-skin contact with Aaron was something that always mesmerized him. They tumbled around in the California king-size bed, kissing and caressing all over each other's bodies. Malachi knew all of Aaron's sweet spots, and she knew all of his. When they finished their second round of lovemaking, they both were exhausted. Malachi pulled Aaron closer as she laid in his arms. She trailed her finger around his left nipple. "When are you gonna let me make you mine again, woman?" he asked. Aaron stopped mid-movement, then peered up at him with a side eye. Boy, bye, you know why. Malachi licked his lips. I'm saying no. What do you even see in that nigga? What do you see in Zoe? Her words were so sharp they felt like a blow to the chest. For more reasons than one, there was a lot Malachi saw in Zoe. She was loving, caring, sweet, reliable. Malachi redirected the subject. A drug dealer, though? Aaron turned to stare at the TV, which was on mute. I told you before, Malachi, I didn't know he was a drug dealer when we first met. I didn't find that out till later. Okay, so why didn't you leave him when you did find out? What, is he better than me in bed or something? Wow, really, dude? Malachi chuckled at that one, though he secretly wondered. If Aaron said yes, it would bruise more than his ego. After a few seconds, he noticed that Aaron wasn't going to answer his question. He decided to ask her another one. Aaron, if we could rewind the hands of time, would you ever be with me again? Huh? Would you ever cheat on me again? He opened his mouth to answer, but their conversation halted as they heard a car door slam outside. Uh-oh, here come the dope man. It sounded like it was coming from the front of the house. Malachi watched as Aaron popped her head up, the color draining from her face. What's up? He asked, feeling nervous at the tension that was displayed across her features. She tumbled out of bed and rushed to the window, peeking outside. Shit, she hissed. She turned back to Malachi. You gotta go. She gestured toward Malachi's clothes strewn across the floor. Malachi was dazed. What? I thought you said, go, Malachi, please hurry. He can't see this. He can't. Her eyes filled with tears. Aaron looked shaky, too shaky. Something was wrong. Malachi hurried to put his clothes on as she did the same, then followed her as she bounded down the stairs to see him out of the back door. Aaron, he said, but she was practically pushing him outside. He was hurt, but the fear in her eyes told him there was much more to why she was acting this way than the fact that her boyfriend was about to catch her cheating. Malachi hurried to his car without thinking. He drove off just as the kitchen lights in Aaron's apartment turned on. His mind was swimming. What the hell had just happened back there? Why was Aaron so afraid? The look in her eyes was way past a normal fear. It was a life-threatening fear. Malachi slammed on the brakes at a light. Wait a minute, that nigga ain't putting his hands on her. Malachi thought back, and the pieces of the puzzle began to stick together. He'd never seen any bruises, or that would have been a dead giveaway. Aaron did always avoid the topic of trying to break up with Banks, though. Malachi now wondered if it was because she tried to in the past and he threatened her. He was definitely going to ask her about it the next time he saw her. Their relationship was kept extremely under wraps because of both of their relationship statuses, but drug dealer or not, Malachi would go apeshit if he ever found out Banks was laying a finger on his woman. On your woman? This bitch ain't your woman, sir. That's the end of that chapter. Okay, I think we might be putting this shit down by the end of chapter 3. This nigga dumb and stupid. Oh my God. Hey, Jazzy, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Hey, Mo, welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here as well. All right. Let me see. I got my next time stamp. Y'all just gotta wait and let it count on down, child. I don't know what y'all think so far. Y'all feeling it a little bit or no? Hey, wifey. Hey, girl. Hey, troublemaking ass. Welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. You good, wifey? Just yes or no. That's it. You don't have to elaborate. All right, here we go. I'm trying to get. Okay, we'll talk about it. All right, y'all. Sorry. Okay, here we go. Chapter 3. Tisk, tisk. The Avenger clicked their tongue as they scrolled through the photos stored on the device. The evidence against Malachi was piling up heavily. It was almost time to make a move. When they did, Malachi wouldn't know what hit him. Wow. And then there's a break in the chapter. Who's the Avenger? Child, what had happened? All right. It was the weekend, so Malachi was headed to pick up his son, Makai, from his mother, Alice's house. Alice had agreed to be the mediator between Malachi and Shartasia ever since she learned of Shartasia's violent tendencies. Wait, what? Oh, okay. So apparently she was putting her hands on him. I don't know. Malachi pulled up in front of his mother's house, ready to hear her mouth. She was always getting on him about one thing or another. He wondered what it would be today. Guess we're about to find out, he sighed, then opened his driver's side door, but swiftly pulled back to avoid it being ripped off the hinges because of Shartasia speeding past him to park by the curb just ahead. She tried to take his ass out, Jack. He wrenched the door back open, his adrenaline levels raising. Shartasia had already pissed him off, and she'd barely entered the scene. What the hell is wrong with you? He asked her as she got out of the driver's seat and Makai exited from the passenger side, his head in his tablet appearing completely unbothered. That's because he already know his mama crazy, so he just look at his tablet and keep on going. Just then, Alice's front door opened and she walked outside. Makai's head popped up. Nana! He shouted, then ran into her waiting arms. The two embraced, and Alice whispered something into Makai's ear, causing him to make a beeline into the house. Alice chuckled, then turned her attention to Malachi and Shartasia. Hold on. All right, sorry, y'all. Hey, Pastor Tracy. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Oh, Naomi, you said it's kind of slow. Yeah, it's a little slow, but we're going to see. We're going to give it a minute. We're going to see what's up. All right. You two playing nice? She asked. I would if this maniac didn't almost hit me with her car, Malachi spouted out. Shartasia sucked her teeth and rolled her eyes. Good Lord, Malachi, it wasn't even that serious. Malachi opened his mouth to clap back, but Alice cut in before the conversation could escalate any further. Shartasia, it's so nice to see you again. What time are you coming back tomorrow? Shartasia smiled, ignoring Malachi's glaring eyes. I'll be back tomorrow at 5, ma'am. Alice returned the gesture. Sounds great. See you soon. Mm-hmm. Shartasia nodded in a chipper tone, then plopped back into her red Toyota Camry and peeled off, blasting a Megan Thee Stallion song. Malachi rolled his eyes. Come on in, Alice said, and he obeyed his mother. When he walked inside, his nostrils were filled with the aroma of his mother's famous chocolate chip cookies. He chuckled at the thought of how his son seemed to love him more than he did as he was growing up. Hungry? Alice asked with a smirk as they entered the kitchen. Just as Malachi suspected, Makai was sitting at the table with at least 10 cookies piled up on a plate, along with a huge glass of milk. I ain't mad at him, shit. That's what I'm talking about. At least 10 cookies. That's how many you need. That's just getting started. Child, I could tear off a whole tray of pecan sandies. Watching a damn Tubi movie. Lord have mercy. Anyway. His son looked to be in a state of euphoria as he took a bite of one of the delicious treats. Don't eat that whole plate, boy, Malachi warned in a stern tone. You're going to end up getting sick. Dad, can we play football today? Makai asked. Malachi opened his mouth to say no, but he saw the look in his mother's eyes. He knew he would be in deep shit if he turned his son down again. He'd been rescheduling this game of catch with his son for the past couple of weekends, always coming up with lame excuses for why he would have to do it the following week. Sure, son, Malachi said instead, and Makai's eyes lit up, his cookies now long forgotten. Yes, I'll go get my gear. Makai pushed away from the table and raced out of the kitchen to head upstairs to the room Alice had for him in her home. Makai often ended up staying with his grandmother rather than his father on Malachi's weekends with him because Malachi was steady coming up with excuses to leave him there. As soon as Makai was out of earshot, Alice turned to Malachi. He sighed. He knew this was coming. What is it, Ma? Don't you what is it me? You need to get a grip on your life and fast, Malachi. I didn't raise you this way. That boy practically begs you for attention, and you leave him here with an old lady? I can't believe. Malachi tuned her out as he reflected on the first part of his mother's tirade. As usual, every word she said was right. It seemed that just like Malachi wasn't shit in the ladies' department, he wasn't much better as a father. That part is going to change today, he resolved in his mind. Malachi had been meaning to spend more time with his son, but the excuses had become a crutch for him. What are you waiting on? His mind asked him. He's your son. What are you going to do? Let the streets raise him? Alice was still going on with her rant, but Malachi's attention returned to her when he heard her mention Aaron's name. What about Aaron? He asked. His mother shook her head. There you go. Don't listen to a word I say until it's about that woman. If she's so important to you, why are you settling for just being with her maintenance man? She held her fingers up for air quotes when she used the term maintenance man. Why don't you just get back with her? That was the million-dollar question, but Malachi definitely was not about to discuss his love life with his mother. Ma, please, stop nagging. I came here to pick up my son, not have you curse me out. Alice put her hand on her hip. Well, somebody needs to, and it might as well be me. I swear, Malachi, with the way you run around half-cocked like you ain't got no sense, you trying to send me to an early grave. Makai raced back into the kitchen, ending Alice's second rant before it began. Ready, Dad? Makai said, looking up at him. Malachi smiled down at his son. He had to chuckle at the fact that he had smeared black paint under his eyes and put on shoulder pads when they were simply going out for a game of catch. Yep, I'm ready, son. Say goodbye to Nana. Bye, Nana, Makai said, then ran for the door. Malachi followed after him, but he stopped when he heard his mother's last words. I know you never listened to me, son, but I feel the need to say this anyway. Hopefully this time it will stick. You keep running around with all these women, and sooner or later, it's going to catch up with you. I always told you, but you never listen. If you keep on playing with fire, one day, you'll end up getting burned. Malachi turned back and looked at her, taking in the serious expression on her face. I know, Ma, I'm settling down, he said, but he knew she didn't believe him. As he walked toward the car to drive to the park with his son, Malachi let his mother's words marinate in his mind. She'd always used that phrase with him as he was growing up, but this time it hit different. Maybe it was time he finally grew up and stopped messing around. When they got to the park, a text buzzed through on Malachi's phone. He glanced at the screen and saw that it was Leia, yet another woman he'd been talking to recently. They hadn't slept together, but they were definitely headed in that direction. Malachi ignored the text and focused on his son. Yeah, maybe his mom was right. He needed to reprioritize his life before it was too late. And that's the end of that chapter. I don't know, child. I'm trying to, Lord have mercy. Irk and Jerk. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. All right. Let me get this next time stamp. All right, hold on. I don't know, y'all. I'm feeling some type of way about this one. I don't even know why, but I'm eels. Hey, Kay. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Child, I don't even know what the hell just happened. My hole you dig is dark. Something happened. Oh, shit, this thing trying to update. Hold on, y'all. Hold on. Okay, sorry, y'all. I had to stop that because no God. All right, now I had to refresh it. Okay, bam. Oh, hey, Dior. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right, let me see. Let me make sure I didn't miss nobody else. Did I miss anybody else? Listen, if I didn't speak to you, you better say something. All right, so we got to definitely... because y'all be killing me. Okay, Nora, thanks for stopping by. Child, we don't know yet. I might get pissed off a little later. We gonna see, though. I hope not, though. All right. I got it. Chapter 4. Malachi enjoyed playing catch with Makai. The more time they spent together, the more Malachi realized his son reminded him of himself at that age. Makai's eyes were so bright, like a person whose mind was opened up to all the world's possibilities. Malachi had been like that once, before reality hit. It started with his own father, Marcus. Alice caught Marcus cheating and threw him out of the house. From that point forward, Marcus never stopped. He was known around town as a rolling stone and had allegedly impregnated 3 different women after Malachi's mother kicked him out, all around the same time. The rumors were never confirmed, but when Malachi saw each woman's offspring, he couldn't help but to believe he was looking at his half-brother and sisters. Malachi saw the devastation that his mother endured as a result of his father's actions, and he vowed to never do the same when he grew up, until he had his first girlfriend in high school, LaTanya. She and Malachi were together for 3 straight years, and Malachi planned to propose on their graduation day. Unfortunately, that dream was dashed the day he walked in on her having sex with one of the teachers at their school. Well, hell, she was trying to get into college, nigga. She wasn't getting ready to settle for no goddamn trash, man. No, just she was trying to get her a Q-dog, you heard me? Because they know how to lay that pot. Sorry. Malachi was more than disgusted and heartbroken. He was scarred. The pain only grew deeper when he found out from Zaire, who he'd met in middle school, that the teacher wasn't the only other person LaTanya had been sleeping with. Malachi was pissed that both Ben and Zaire knew this information and withheld it from him. But they said they thought it would be best if he found out himself since he was head over heels in love. From that point on, Malachi's heart hardened. He ran through bitches left and right in college, quickly rising to fame for the numbers he was putting up. He had so much game, he even pulled a few of his professors, which led him to graduate with high honors. see. And still turned into a fucking trash man. But okay. After graduation, he met Aaron and they started a relationship. Things were going well until he started getting scared. He began having flashbacks about LaTanya and what she had done to him. They bothered him so much that he started popping up on Aaron at work and other places just to make sure she was where she said she would be. Then, when he saw her walking in the mall one day with another man, he flipped his lid. He didn't even let her know he had seen her. He went to a party that night, ignoring Aaron's phone calls and text messages, asking where he was and why he wasn't answering her. He met and fucked Shartasia that night, then found out the next day that the man Aaron was walking with was her flesh and blood cousin, who had just come down to visit the family as a surprise. Malachi felt like the scum of the earth, and matters only became worse when Shartasia turned up pregnant. He adamantly denied that the baby was his and demanded a prenatal DNA test, refusing to lift a finger in Shartasia's direction until he had full proof the child was his. "You fucked me the same night we met," he scoffed. "Who's to say you ain't do the same thing with another nigga?" A few weeks later, the results came back showing that Malachi was the father. Shartasia refused to get an abortion, so Malachi was forced to come clean to Aaron. He broke her heart that day, and she said she never wanted to see him again. Malachi drifted aimlessly for weeks while Shartasia begged him to work things out with her for the sake of their unborn child. He finally gave in, figuring that was the best decision for the kid. 5 years after Makai was born, Malachi ran into Aaron at the supermarket. Sparks flew between them like they'd never broken up. One thing led to another, and they ended up in a hotel room. That night led to many more nights before Shartasia found out and almost killed Malachi by running him down with her car. That's the reason why he was so nervous and shit. Oh, my God. Wait, who the hell? Oh, child. Hey, Creole Patra. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. She said, hey, I said. God damn it. Hey, girl. Hey, I didn't see you, child. Listen. Oh, my God. Y'all are a mess. Okay. Malachi's heart broke once again when he found out a few days later that Aaron was in a relationship with Banks. He was still in the hospital healing from his wounds. "Leave him," he had said when she told him about Banks. "We can start over." "I can't," Aaron said, then looked away. "Why not? You can't tell me you're not feeling what I'm feeling, Aaron." She stared straight ahead, refusing to look in his eyes. "You have a son." Malachi's response was immediate. "Let me worry about that. What about your baby mother?" "Don't worry about her. I'll pay child support. I'll do whatever. I don't want her. I want you, Aaron. I don't regret my son, but I regret ever messing with that girl. If I could turn back the hands of time, I would have never even gone to that party that night." Malachi's heart was beating uncontrollably. He prayed with all his might she would say yes. A few moments passed, and she still hadn't responded. "Aaron?" he asked, still hopeful. Aaron refused to respond to his statement. "I have to go," she said. Malachi called after her, but she kept walking. 2 years after that, Malachi met Zoe. They hit it off nicely, and Malachi felt like he was finally ready to settle down. Their relationship went smoothly for a while until he ran into Aaron yet again. She was still with Banks, but her eyes lit up at the sight of Malachi. They told each other they would just be friends, and Malachi held out as long as he could before he gave in again. The problem was that he had also given in to Shartasia a few times too, but for entirely different reasons. Now Malachi had 3 different women with a 4th in his back pocket. He didn't know what to do. And there's a break in the chapter. This nigga's dumb. He really is fucking dumb. Okay. Hello, Fatima Dukes is Fly. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Y'all welcome, Fatima, to the Speakeasy, please. Let me see. All right. Child, they got more breaks in this damn chapter. Hold on. Malachi headed to work the next morning, thinking about his son and the way he should navigate his relationships with the women in his life. He knew he couldn't keep going the way he was going, despite the excitement of it all. The confusion was worse than the excitement, and it was becoming more pronounced by the day. Malachi opened his locker to grab his uniform and put it on when a piece of paper slid out and wafted to the floor. He bent to pick it up, then sucked his teeth when he saw that it was a note with... what? Well, with pasted letters that had been cut out from magazines. "Tell Zoe what you did," it read. It was signed The Avenger. The Avenger? What kind of shit is this? Malachi's nose wrinkled. Clearly, someone was playing tricks on him, but he didn't have time to figure out who it could be. Plenty of people knew he was in a relationship with Zoe, and a few of them probably knew he was cheating, too. He would have taken the note more seriously if it wasn't signed with that childish-ass name, though. The Avenger, he said, then chuckled before slamming his locker and heading out for a shift. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. What the fuck? I want to know who it is, okay? I'm like, what the hell? I'm trying to, and why? Like, why are you going through this? I guess that's what we're going to find out, because he's Aaron's maintenance man. And apparently, Shartasia's too. I guess she only try to run him over when he ain't passing out peen in her direction. I'm guessing. I don't know, but like, what the hell? I have no idea, but he's stupid. And she done. All right, let's see. Chapter 5. Malachi and Zoe stared across the restaurant table at each other. It was nights like this that Malachi felt he was doing something right. He and Zoe's relationship had matured to the point where they were getting really serious, and Malachi had already been searching for rings at various jewelers. Zoe wore a look of admiration and love in her eyes. "What are you thinking about?" she asked. "Taking you down tonight," he responded in a seductive tone. She blushed. "Taking me down? Is that what we call it now?" Malachi chuckled and took a sip of his Chardonnay. "How's work been?" It was then that he noticed the tiny bags under Zoe's eyes. The once smooth-tasting wine now felt like bitterness traveling down his throat. What the hell was he doing to this woman? She was running herself ragged, working all kinds of doubles and saving up money for a future with him while he was running around with various women behind her back. A faraway look crossed Zoe's features. Then she answered, "Work is fine. It's not so bad at the hospital, just tiring." She yawned and Malachi felt even worse. Zoe would never let on, but he knew all those hours were wearing her down. "You know, you don't have to do all that overtime. Maybe you can cut back some. We'll still get to our goal." "I know, but we're so close," she said. "And I don't want my mom and dad thinking they ever gave me shit. I worked hard for this house, me and you." That was something Malachi didn't understand about his woman. Zoe's parents had plenty of money to give them for the down payment on their $450,000 home, but Zoe refused to accept it. She also turned down an executive position at her father's company, choosing to work as a medical assistant at the hospital instead. In Malachi's mind, that was a dumbass move, especially seeing that Zoe's father would likely have paid her over $100,000 a year, plus bonuses, to show up and not do shit. But Zoe always told him she wanted to pave her own way. "I don't want them as my crutch, Malachi," she had said. "Your crutch," Malachi had said back. He couldn't believe his ears. Zoe had grown up with a silver spoon in her mouth, but she chose the hard life, while Malachi would have given anything to grow up in a normal household with a mother and father who gave him everything he wanted and needed. Okay, fast forward. This nigga's jealous of this motherfucker. And no, she wants to do it on her own. Because when people do shit for you, especially parents, they can hold it over your fucking head. Right. So, and don't nobody want that shit. Don't nobody want it. She's probably oblivious to the fact that he's cheating because she working so goddamn much. Right. That part. And here his dog ass is out here fucking around. Man. All right. I ain't gonna get riled up yet. All right, so here we go. Instead, Alice struggled like a motherfucker working two jobs to support him, while his father never lifted a finger. He was always too busy with his bitches. Malachi snapped out of his flashbacks as his hypocrisy hit him like a slap in the face. He was moving exactly like his father always moved. Malachi's father, Marcus, was still around, but not for long. He'd been diagnosed with cancer and was only given a few more months to live. Despite the fact that Malachi hated his father for not being there for him while he was growing up, he didn't want to see the man die. When Marcus passed on, it would be nothing but an opportunity wasted, a life squandered, chasing all the wrong things instead of just doing what was right. And look at you, you're doing the same thing to your woman that Marcus did to your mom, not to mention your relationship with your own damn son. Zoe was saying something, but Malachi was lost in thought. He needed to snap out of his bullshit and quick. He resolved in his mind that change was coming. He was not going to be like his father. He was going to be the good man, the loving husband and doting father he always envisioned himself as in the future. He already had a son, but the question was, who would his woman be? Malachi, did you hear anything I just said? Zoe was asking. He refocused back on her. I'm sorry, baby. I spaced out for a second. What was it? She looked concerned. What's wrong with you? He shook his head. Nothing. Just thinking about picking up some more hours myself so you won't have to work so hard. I know you have drive and ambition, but I want to provide for you. You don't have to overexert yourself. He covered her hand with his and saw a hint of a smile on her face. I don't want you overworking yourself either, though, she said. He shook his head again. I won't. Besides, I'm a man. It's my job to sweat during the day and make you sweat at night. His seductive overtones were not missed. Zoe was blushing again, and it turned Malachi on to no end. She fanned herself. Well, I kind of feel like sweating now. Shit, say less. Malachi signaled for their server. Race you to the car. When they got home, Malachi put it on Zoe like he never had before. She was screaming his name as they were caught up in the throes of passion. During their lovemaking, Malachi was focused on pleasing his woman, but he was also thinking about life. In his heart, he was ready to start making better decisions, but he needed to figure out exactly how he was going to do that. He couldn't exactly cut Shartasia out of his life, saying that she was the mother of his son, but sex with her could certainly stop. Would she snitch, though? He asked himself. He prayed she wouldn't. He couldn't take Zoe's heart being broken over him fucking around on her. He and Leah hadn't done anything sexual yet, but he could tell she liked him a lot. She would be the easiest to let go of, but he had to find a way to break things off gently. Aaron, he didn't even want to think about that. She should have been easy to stop messing with, too, seeing that she and Banks had been going steady for years, but Malachi was trying to be as honest as possible with himself. He didn't know if he would be able to just walk away from her like that. Well, then, walk away from Zoe. Break her heart now, just a little bit. And instead of waiting till y'all get in a house and she thinking y'all making a fucking life and you out here fucking busting up in everybody raw and got two more damn chilling on her. Hell, fuck, nigga. Anyway. After Zoe was thoroughly pleased, she fell fast asleep. Malachi loved that angelic look on her face she carried while she slept. He leaned over and kissed her lips. Then he heard his phone buzz with a text message. He ain't even want to look at it to see who it was because he knew it was one of his women. Definitely either Shartasia or Leah, who had no problems reaching out to him at this time of night. Aaron usually only contacted him during work hours. And he did the same with her. Neither wanted to get caught, though they both knew they were playing a dangerous game. The phone buzzed again, and Malachi reached over to grab it so he could delete the messages, then turn it off. It was Leah. Hey, sexy, haven't heard from you in a while. What's up? Leah didn't know Malachi was in a full-blown relationship. The lie had effortlessly rolled off his lips when she asked if he was single. He knew when he first met her in front of the sandwich spot that he had no business messing with her, but her persona was so alluring, she just drew him in. He couldn't help but to talk to her and ask for her number. They'd gone on a few dates and had a great time on all of them. She told him she wanted to take things slow before having sex because she felt like she rushed things in her last relationship, and Malachi agreed. He could tell that she was starting to drop her defenses, though. Against his better judgment, he shot her a quick text back with a lame excuse about being busy with work, but promising to get up with her within the next week. You really ain't shit, his mind told him after he read her response, then deleted their thread. Leah's name wasn't even saved in his phone, but she thought they were moving towards something serious. Malachi really needed to make some changes in his life. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, they about to kill this nigga. Everybody gonna link up. Mad bitches linking up. They are gonna have a group stabbing. I can feel it. They just gonna stand around his ass in a circle while he's strapped to the dining room table, and they're gonna poke his ass up. Yep. They're gonna leave holes in his ass like he done left holes in their hearts. Yep. All right, I got my time stamp. Let's let it count on down. Chapter 6. Marcus wasn't doing good at all. Malachi had gone to see him at the hospice center when he received a call from the doctor saying his condition was worsening. Malachi was listed as his father's emergency contact since his father never married and didn't have any type of relationship with his other alleged children. So why the fuck you gotta be the contact? Fuck that nigga. Since he was such a goddamn rolling stone, let him roll his ass right on to hell. Shit. The fuck? So you gotta be the one bussing up there to see this old ass nigga? Fuck him. Anyway, that sounds real cold, don't it? I don't give a fuck. Fuck him. He was a bad dad and the reason why his son's a fucking loser now. The visit was depressing, to say the least. Marcus didn't have much to say to Malachi because he barely knew him. The only thing he could do with his son was harp on memories of the past, before he and Alice split, before Malachi turned 8. Here Malachi was, a grown-ass man, and he was forced to listen to the same memories over and over again. Sometimes he wanted to snap at his father and say, "It's great that you loved me when I was 7, but what about now?" Malachi was pushing 35 while his father was stuck in a time warp, and this is exactly where you're headed if you don't shape up. Malachi's conscience was on him heavy lately. He wondered if his mother had been praying or something. Oh my God, listen. One day remind me to tell y'all the story. Where my husband was like, "Every time you get in front of that goddamn altar, some shit go down." Indeed. Stop fucking playing. Hey, Jasmine. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Right. Quit playing. Shit. When I ask you a question, answer me. And the answer should be yes. Because everything I ask for, the answer should just be yes. It's me, Mario. Anyway, she always told him that God told her things about him when he was younger, falling into mischief and then getting caught. "How do you always know what I'm doing?" he'd finally asked her one day. Alice couldn't help but to smile at her son's misguided frustration. "Honey, I'm a mother. God shows me things about you, whether you like it or not." Then she started trying to tell him about prayer, but 12-year-old Malachi wasn't trying to hear all that. He was trying to go back outside so he could get into some more mischief and hopefully not get caught this time. Bitterness had been festering in his heart toward his father even then, because Malachi would often wonder if God also told things to Marcus about his son. If so, he never acted on it, saying that once he was kicked out, they barely saw each other. Malachi's mind flashed to Makai, his son. He wasn't going out like that. And there's a break in the chapter. This Avenger person was getting a little too reckless for Malachi's liking. He found another note in his work locker using the same cutout magazine letters as the other one, except a picture of Makai was also glued to the note. Pity if this son lost his father or if the father lost his son. Malachi slammed his locker in frustration, his protective instincts on the uprise. He called Shartaja's phone immediately. "Hello," she answered, sounding like she was driving. "Where's Makai?" She paused. "Excuse me. Where's my son, Shartaja?" "Your son is in school. I just dropped him off. Why the hell are you so bothered about his whereabouts all of a sudden?" Malachi calmed down. He'd flown off the handle at her and he knew it. "My bad. It's just nothing. He was telling me about his teacher. How is she treating him?" It was a damn lie, but that was the best Malachi could do at the moment without sounding crazy and telling Shartaja about the Avenger notes. Shartaja caught on immediately. "The teacher is a he. and Makai is doing fine. Why are you really calling me, Malachi? I just wanted to see how he was doing. Look, I'll talk to you later. My break is over. That was another lie, seeing as that it was the beginning of his shift. Shartasia knew that, since she knew his work schedule, but Malachi hung up on her before he could say anything further. Shartasia tried to call him back, but he didn't answer. She sent him a voice clip to his inbox next. I don't know what's gotten into your rude ass lately, but it ain't cute, and you need to stop. Anyway, if you're really that concerned about your son all of a sudden, there is a parent-teacher conference coming up. Let me know if you're coming, and I'll give you the details. Malachi didn't want to call Shartasia to apologize for being rude because he wasn't trying to have an extended conversation, so he texted her instead, saying he was definitely coming to the meeting. He also asked for details. Shartasia shot back the school's phone number in response. Bitch, he said. Then he felt bad about using that type of terminology to describe the mother of his child. Hell, if the goddamn shoe fits, lace that motherfucker up. But that's the end of that chapter, so. I don't understand it. What's the problem, sir? If she acting like a bitch, you know, like what the hell? All right, let me get it. But don't listen to me. I tell y'all all the time, don't listen to me. Mm-mm. Don't let me get y'all in trouble. All right, I got my time stamp. Let it count down while I wet my whistle, please. Chapter 7. Malachi had the unsettling feeling that he was in too deep, but at the same time, he felt he couldn't help himself. He showed up to Ben's house on poker night with two plastic bags in hand. What's that? Zaire asked, gesturing at the bags. Ben's expression darkened, like he already knew. Malachi swallowed his guilt, then smiled. Got a date with Leia. Ben sighed and Zaire shook his head in amazement. Damn, nigga, you're like the Energizer Bunny. How do you keep up with all these women? You mean to tell me you never mixed up none of their names or anything? Malachi smirked. Nope, never. Ben went to the bathroom without saying a word. I bet you Ben is the nigga putting the shit in his fucking locker. That's probably it, y'all. Ben is probably digging either on Zoe or Aaron. One of the two of them, he digging on somebody. And he mad because he ain't a player from the Himalayas, even though Malachi's a piece of shit. But whatever. What's wrong with him? Malachi asked Zaire. Zaire rolled his eyes. Sabrina, most likely. Malachi shook his head. We keep telling him to cut that chick loose. He laid the bag containing his silk shirt across the back of the couch in Ben's living room, then put the bag containing his shoebox on the seat of the couch. You better make sure you leave your tags and receipts here, Ben remarked, returning from the bathroom with a sullen expression on his face. I would hate it if Zoe found out you were cheating. Malachi paused, studying his friend. Realization dawned. So you found out about Sabrina and her ex, huh? He asked. Ben stared straight ahead when he sat at the kitchen table. Yup. Zaire's grin erased. Look, man, we'll find you another chick. I'm tired of talking to all these different women, Zaire. But what's it gonna take to finally find one who's right for me? I don't understand it. I don't cheat. I don't lie. I'm straightforward. I do everything I can to let these women know I'm serious about them, but they always end up playing me, and it's usually with some scumbag who... Ben's eyes shifted to Malachi before staring straight ahead again. Malachi felt some type of way about Ben alluding to the fact that he was a scumbag, but he decided not to address it. Ben was already down. It didn't make sense to throw dirt on him. Zaire took over. Look, nigga, we keep trying to give you advice. If you don't want to listen, what are we supposed to do? The advice y'all give me goes against my morals. I'm not trying to be just like the men these women leave me for. Again, Malachi felt the undertone. Or maybe it wasn't an undertone. Maybe he was just being sensitive because he knew he wasn't shit. Jasmine from my mom's church asked about you, he offered. Malachi, Ben, and Zaire had visited his mom's church a few times since she was always hounding them about giving their lives to God. Ben was the only one who seemed halfway interested, and he had made eyes with this cute sister named Jasmine, who was a member there. Isn't she like a preacher or something, though? Zaire cut in. Malachi shrugged. So what? That's probably the kind of woman he needs. Ben still wasn't talking, so Malachi and Zaire decided to skip poker and just catch sports highlights. They laughed and joked, and Ben seemed to lighten up a little. Malachi urged him to find Jasmine on social media and send her a friend request. He did, and thankfully, she accepted. See, homie, there's hope. I heard nothing but good things about Jasmine, Malachi said. She's on the straight and narrow, just like you. As soon as he said those words, he was filled with guilt. Here he was trying to hook his do-gooder friend up with some do-gooder chick, but he was part of the reason those types of people had such a hard time finding someone to settle down with. After this date with Leah, he was gonna figure this thing out. Nigga, figure it out before the date, fuckboy. So I'm gonna cheat this one last time. Oh my God. All right. No, you need to break things off at the date, his mind told him. Matter of fact, don't even go. He thought about flaking as he changed clothes in Ben's bathroom and splashed on some cologne. When he exited, his mind had changed yet again. He decided to just go on a date, see how the conversation went. If Leah gave him an opening, he would let her down gently. Malachi avoided Ben's eyes and Zaire's digs as he made his way out of Ben's apartment and to his car. His conscience spoke yet again, telling him this was a bad idea when he already had enough women in his life, but he ignored it. He pulled up to the restaurant and Leah pulled in right beside him, all smiles. His heart warmed just by seeing her and his breath caught in his throat at the sight of her little black dress and peep-toe pumps. Changing his life was going to be much easier said than done. And that's the end of that chapter. Hey, yo, Buck, call your homeboy Malachi. He need a few of your words of wisdom, good sir. But you need to call him. Yes, indeed. You need to call his ass directly. All right. Got my time stamp. We gonna let it count. I don't think y'all sleep. Are y'all not liking this? Because y'all damn sure ain't talking. That's what I'm wondering, Buck. Like, hell, the fuck is going on, pimping? Everybody quiet like good little kids sitting in a reading circle. Chapter 8. Despite the fact that his son was 9 years old and in the fourth grade, Malachi could count on one hand how many parent-teacher conferences he'd attended. He felt half guilty, half elated that he was finally making moves in the right direction. His car was getting detailed, so he was riding with Chartasia to the event. He knew that would make his son and his son's mother happy for different reasons. Remember, his teacher's name is Mr. Martin, Chartasia was saying. She was acting all giggly and excited like they were going on a date or something. Malachi nodded. Right, got it. Chartasia pulled onto the highway, then turned the music down a few notches. So, what made you decide to come? There was that excited smile again. Why is she looking like that? He thought. Like I said, I just want to see how he's doing. Her smile faltered slightly, then she spoke again. Oh, I was thinking maybe. Never mind. Malachi's interest was piqued. Never mind what? Nothing, Malachi. Malachi didn't know whether he should press it or leave it alone. Chartasia reached to turn the music back up, but stopped herself. She turned to him before focusing back on the road. Do you ever think about us getting back together? Makai's growing up, and pretty soon he'll hit puberty. He's gonna need a man around him full time. Malachi didn't know how to respond to that. I know, he finally answered. That's one of the reasons I'm making it a point to get more involved. But what about my other question, though? Chartasia's tone had changed to a different octave, and it looked like she was getting upset. Chartasia, you know I'm with Zoe. I'm planning to propose to her soon. That was the wrong answer. Chartasia gripped the steering wheel tighter. Yeah, I find it funny how you about to propose to this bitch after being with her only 2 years, when you were with me for 5 and we had a son, but you never mentioned marriage. Malachi opened his mouth to answer, but he thought better about it. Suddenly, he felt Chartasia's pain. It was true that their relationship only started because of a one-night stand that led to a pregnancy, but Chartasia was right that they had been together for over 5 years before Malachi cheated with Aaron. Marriage had never crossed his mind. I'm sorry it didn't work out, was all he could say. Yeah, Chartasia increased her speed. Malachi noticed that she was already passing other cars when the conversation started, but now she was barely missing them as she switched lanes. Shartasia, slow down. You're going to get us pulled over. I don't give a fuck, Malachi. I'm sick of your shit. He was getting scared now. Shartasia had just missed another car as she switched into yet another lane. He prayed the exit for Makai's school would come up soon. Sick of what shit? Please, slow down. You can't whip your car like that with so much traffic. Why do you care? You never cared about me. Shartasia looked at him when she said that, so she didn't realize the traffic was slowing because of an accident up ahead. Shartasia! He screamed as they swiftly approached the back end of an 18-wheeler. Shartasia braked, swerved, then swerved again, ending up on the shoulder of the highway as her vehicle slid several more yards before finally reaching a stop. Malachi's mind and body were tense all over. Shartasia looked unbothered, however. She clicked her blinker to get back into the lane, took the exit, and pulled up to Makai's school like nothing just happened. This bitch is fucking crazy. That's me talking. That ain't in the book, but this bitch is crazy. All right. Malachi shook his head, thanking God for sparing their lives as he walked toward the school building. If he ever considered getting back with Shartasia before this incident, those thoughts were dead now. She would always just be the mother of his son, and he vowed in that moment to never sleep with her again. He realized that was probably why she thought they were getting back together. He'd been keeping the door open by continuing their sexual relationship. That was ending today. He met Malachi's teacher, Mr. Martin, who turned out to be a pretty cool guy. Mr. Martin explained that Makai was doing great and that they were considering him for a robotics camp, which was held in the summertime since he seemed so fascinated by the subject. Robotics? Malachi lit up. Really? He looked down at his son, who had joined the meeting from his after-school program. Makai smiled up at him, happy that his father was proud of him. Malachi felt a rush of emotion in that moment. Yes, we'll send him to the camp, he said, forcing himself not to get choked up. Whatever it costs, I'll pay for it. Shartasia looked at him in surprise. It costs over $3,000, Malachi. She had a warning in her tone, and Malachi knew why. He and Shartasia would never work out as a couple, but she was a hell of a mother, and she probably would kill him if he ever promised Makai something like this, then reneged. I don't care how much it costs, he said, to let her know he was serious. If Makai wants to go, I got it. Yes, Makai said, jumping up and down. Mr. Martin stared between Malachi and Shartasia, but didn't comment any further. When they were exiting the school, Malachi ordered an Uber to the dealership to pick up his car. He knew Makai would be disappointed he wasn't riding back with him, but Malachi couldn't afford Shartasia doing anything else crazy during the drive home. Okay, because that bitch cornbread ain't done. All right, that's the end of that chapter. She clearly, left the top half of her shit at the crib in the dryer. What the hell? Because listen, this chick is, Jesus, she doing too much. Child, I don't even know. I don't know. Do people ever understand the concept of context? I don't know, but okay. Like when y'all be writing, you know, posts on social media, do y'all, you know, give enough of the shit for the story, or, you know, are you just out here going, and that's why your mama's a fucking bitch, right? To nobody in particular. Like how the fuck are we supposed to know? it's just typed real. It's typed real angry. I'll be reading it like, damn. Who they pissed off at, right? Like people don't give context. Like you should have put in there to my baby daddy. Put an address on that shit so we know. I don't know why that tickles me so much, y'all, but like social media is fucking annoying because people forget grammar. They forget tact, decorum, manners, morals, values, their goddamn brains. They forget all of that. They just type just pure, raw, unadulterated emotion, which is like the stupidest shit you could ever possibly think of, right? Think about your emotions. Next time you get really pissed off, just write down every fucking thing you're thinking and then fold it up. Don't read it. Just fold it up and put it away somewhere. 2 days later, go back and read that shit. You're going to be like, what crazy motherfucker wrote this? You. I promise you. It's That shit, I promise you, it is going to tickle the fuck out of you. Yeah, that's a stream of consciousness exercise. You be writing all types of shit. Think about how much shit crossed through your mind while you just walking from upstairs in your house to downstairs. You have 51 fucking thoughts. None of them have anything to do with each other. But you entertain every single one of them because your shit ain't done. That's why you do that shit. I promise you. You walking around toting all your fucking burdens like a goddamn high school book bag. Drop that shit off somewhere. All right. Here we go. Chapter 9. The Avengers stood back, admiring their handiwork in the lower-level parking garage at Malachi's job. They clicked their tongue, then chuckled. Wait till he sees this. Snapping a few photos for keepsakes, they hurried to their car before anyone spotted them. Swiping a false employee badge to get out of the garage, the Avenger could not wait till Malachi saw what they had done. And there's a break in the chapter. Whoever this is got a little bit too much glee for me. Little Mama said, I'm unpacking. Ken settled in my new spot. The book straight to me. Oh, okay. All right. Okay, Little Mama. That's what I'm saying. Let us entertain you. All right, let me see. Hey, Siggy Lou, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Y'all welcome, Siggy Lou. Hey, Peanut. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here with your late ass. Why the fuck are you 9 chapters late? Where you been? I don't want to hear about it. 5 more for you. Thank you. All right. Malachi had a rough day at work, but it got even rougher when he saw that his freshly detailed car had been vandalized. What the fuck? He barked, stalking over to see the damage. Other employees were congregating around the vehicle as well. Malachi pushed through the crowd that had been forming before he got to his car's location. Ooh-wee, said Pedro, one of his co-workers. She wrong for that. They got you good with that one. Another co-worker whistled while others laughed. Malachi saw red. He had just paid over $500 for a full detail the day before, and now his front and back window shields would likely need to be replaced. Someone had glued male review photos and posters to the glass. Malachi tried to rip some of it off, but there was only more underneath. He fought to keep control. Damn, homie, Pedro said, looking like he felt bad now. You want to ride home? Malachi ignored him and pushed back through the crowd, walking outside the garage to call a tow truck to go back to the dealership along with an Uber. He didn't have the words right now for Chartasia, but she would definitely be hearing from him about this. It was one thing to sneak notes into his locker, but it was another thing to cause actual damage to his car. How did she even get access to the building? He asked himself. He couldn't worry about that now. He had to focus on getting this car fixed, hoping it could all be done today. Chartasia called him right after he forked over almost $1,000 to the dealership. Well, he seems to have a little change, you heard me, so I don't know. Thankfully, they would be able to replace his windshield and back window today, so he wouldn't have to make other arrangements for transportation over the week. What? He answered. Hello, she said in a sing-song voice. What are you doing? You know what I'm doing. I don't appreciate what you did. I should sue your ass. A tone changed. What are you talking about? Malachi didn't have time for her lies. Look, Chartasia, these silly-ass games you playing, they stop today. You do one more thing and I'm filing for harassment. Malachi, what are you? He hung up before he ended up saying something he would later regret to the mother of his child. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, well. Mm-hmm. I guess. This is a mess. All right, let me see. Did she ever answer my question? No, she didn't. That's all right. Okay. Tell me she 25 minutes behind. Why the hell you 25 minutes behind and just now chit-chatting? I don't even want to hear about it. Mm-mm. 15 more for you just because you being vague. All right, let me get this time stamp. You too vague for me, for somebody who late and 25 minutes behind catching up. Telling me you vibing with it. You better be vibing with it. Hell, you're late. You ain't got no choice but to vibe with it. The damn voting period is over. Jay like, hey, yo, what Mr. Nigga do to you? Nothing. Not a damn thing. I was looking for your ass. That's why I'm upset. I expected you to be here. Mm-hmm. You don't remember that you the one that was rooting for this book when I first read the synopsis, I don't know how long ago. Mm-hmm. You rooted for that book. That's all right. Chapter 10. Malachi stared down at Marcus from a standing position. It was finally hitting him that this was it. There was no hope for his father to get better, to return to the healthy ox of a man he once was. Marcus was nothing but a shell of himself now. Malachi was both amazed and depressed by how the illness had spread and caused his father to wither up like a leaf. Marcus was so tiny, he was barely bigger than Makai now. Marcus tried to utter a few words, but his voice was really weak. For the second time in a matter of a few days, Malachi felt himself getting choked up. Why was he robbed of a relationship with his father? Why hadn't Marcus ever gotten to the point where he decided enough was enough and that there were more important things in life than chasing women? Again, Malachi's hypocrisy was burning him up. He really needed to do better. When he got home, Zoe immediately noticed that something was off. Malachi, what is it? She asked, walking over to him with concern in her eyes. He just shook his head. Talk to me, she urged, reaching out to grab one of his hands. The simple gesture almost broke him. Here Zoe was, bending over backwards to see about him while he... Malachi shook his head again. It's just my dad, he responded. Is he getting worse? Malachi nodded. Zoe's eyes clouded. Oh, baby, I know how tough this is for you. She wrapped her arms around him and Malachi returned the gesture. He blinked back his emotions and tried to focus on better things, but found himself wondering exactly what those better things were. Sure, there was good in his life. He still had his mother for the foreseeable future. He had his son, his job, his friends, and his woman, but his other activities were what Malachi needed to get away. He broke the hug from Zoe and changed the tone of the conversation. You want to catch a movie or something? Zoe appeared to be startled by his abrupt change in demeanor, but she agreed. Sure, let me throw something on really quick. Malachi plopped onto the couch while he waited for Zoe to get ready. Then, when she reappeared in the living room, he wordlessly exited their apartment with her walking behind him. Oh, shit, I thought they was about to sit down and Netflix and chill. This nigga actually meant like a motherfucking go to the show. Okay. They went to see some action movie that everyone had been raving about, but Malachi barely paid attention. He thought going to the movies would distract him from his troubles, but it didn't. He needed something more, maybe a trip out of town. He glanced at Zoe, wondering what she would say if he suggested they get away for a week or two. No, she would probably start yelling about her work schedule or something. Zoe worked 6 days a week, sometimes seven. Malachi didn't know how she did it, but his woman was driven. He decided to do some more thinking and planning before he sprung an idea for a trip on her. It needed to be something sensible that wouldn't draw them too far away from their goal of saving money for their house. And that's the end of their chapter, of that chapter. He's so fucking dumb. Like, I don't like this guy. He's a dummy. That's the only thing I can think is that he's fucking stupid. Yeah. That's all I got. He's a fucking idiot. I tried, but he's an idiot. Sorry. You know, but it's a whole lot of Malachis out in the world, and that's a shame. You know, I'm thinking about their kids, fucking bastard. Chapter 11. Malachi left work the next day feeling famished. He'd forgotten to bring his lunch like he normally did, so he decided to stop by a drive-thru to feed his grumbling stomach. He pulled up behind a familiar vehicle and for a few moments he racked his brains trying to remember who it was. The person paid for their meal, then pulled into a parking space, presumably to eat their food. Malachi decided to pull up next to the vehicle to see who it was. She was focused on her sandwich, but Malachi could clearly see that it was Aaron. He would normally have immediately recognized her car, but the location of this fast food spot was on the other side of town from where she lived, and Aaron was somewhat of a homebody. Malachi hadn't heard from her in over a week, which was uncharacteristic, but he had so much going on, he hadn't reached out to her either. His mind flashed back to their last time together when Banks almost caught him. Aaron smoothed her silky hair behind her ear before taking another bite of her burger, and Malachi's blood began to boil when he saw the unmistakable bruise under her eye. What the fuck happened to her? He spat. His food long forgotten, Malachi jumped out of his vehicle and stalked over to Aaron's passenger side window. She jumped and almost dropped her food when he rapped on the window. She looked at him with wide eyes but didn't roll the window down. What happened, Aaron? He gestured for her to open the door. She didn't. Aaron looked frightened as she stumbled over her actions. It looked as if she was deciding between talking to him or just putting the car in reverse and peeling out of the parking lot. Aaron, Malachi repeated. She shook her head, then put the car in reverse. Malachi watched as she backed out of her space, then pulled out of the lot, taking a turn down a side street. He was confused as hell. Had Banks done that to her? He'd kill him. Why was Aaron running from him, though? Did she think he wouldn't help her? He tried calling her cell, but the number was disconnected. What the hell? Malachi's heart dropped. Aaron had that same number for years. Why did she change it? He had to follow her. He sprang into action, hopping back into his vehicle and heading toward the apartment Aaron shared with Banks. He didn't care if Banks was there or not. Malachi would kill him before he allowed him to. Malachi's dash lit up with a text from an unknown number. He gave a voice command for his vehicle to read the text to him as he turned at a light. Pause. Do Tauruses read text messages? I don't know. Are Ford Tauruses that fancy? I thought he drove a Ford Taurus. That's kind of fancy. That's, you know, a little fancy for a Ford Taurus, ain't it? That's kind of like a all-purpose vehicle, you know what I'm saying? It don't usually have all the bells and whistles like that. I don't know, but okay. Anyway, Malachi, this is Aaron. Please don't follow me. Banks suspects us, so I have to break things off. Malachi's ears grew hot. His suspicions were confirmed. Banks did put his hands on Aaron. Why was she staying with him? Did he threaten her? Malachi drove faster, desperate to get to her place so they could talk face to face. His heart sank when he pulled up and she wasn't there. He texted the number she texted him from, but it didn't go through. He tried to call it, but he was blocked. As a last-ditch effort, he drove by Aaron's job, slowly circling the parking lot to see if he saw her car. But it wasn't there. Aaron was clearly in trouble, but Malachi didn't know how to help her. That's not your job, motherfucker. Help your bitch by being faithful to her, right? Help your son by being reliable for him. Stupid bastard. Child, listen. Oh, the newer ones do, Buck? Child, I ain't know. I ain't know, child. Oh, Lord, child. Listen. Let me get this damn timestamp. Y'all so silly. Wait, she said Taurus males don't read their texts either. Well, we don't know what his astrological sign is, but we know that he drives a Ford Taurus. Oh, child. I don't know. He probably old Aries type dude. They some old philanderers like that. And child, I could never be with an Aries. Yuck. Mm-mm, honey. No. It would be a rose before an Aries. No, God. Because, child, I'd be an orange somewhere. All right. Chapter 12. Malachi made his way home to see something strange. There was a swarm of flies around his mailbox, which was propped open. What's going on here? He asked as he pulled up. He got out of his vehicle and walked toward the mailbox. There was a foul stench coming from it. Since it was already open, it wasn't hard to see what was causing the smell. There was a dead and decaying squirrel laying belly up on top of his mail. Oh, my God, Malachi said. He looked to his left, then to his right, to see if anyone suspicious was lingering around. He saw no one. He had to get rid of the animal before Zoe came home. He didn't want her freaking out over his bullshit. He hurried to their front door, but stopped short, swiping his blade from his pocket just in case. The door didn't look like it had been tampered with, but Malachi couldn't be too sure. He let himself in and was hit with a similar putrid smell from the mailbox. He didn't need to wonder where it was coming from. Straight ahead of him on the living room wall were words written in what looked like blood, probably from the squirrel. "This will be you if you keep playing," the Avenger had written. Oh, shit. Wow. Damn, they can get into his crib. Now he gotta stop and think that, hey, this is somebody with a key. You know, child, listen, I don't know, this nigga dumb. All right, chills ran down Malachi's spine. This situation was getting sick. He sprang into action, grabbing some gloves and cleaning supplies. He went to work on the wall first, praying the blood would come off easily. Thankfully, it did, but the awful smell was lingering in the air. Malachi thought to grab some plug-in air fresheners to help cover it up. He couldn't have Zoe coming home asking questions. He went to clean the mailbox before heading to the store for the plug-ins. Thankfully, none of the mail was addressed to Zoe, so Malachi threw it in the dumpster near the store, since the envelopes had the animal smell on them, too. When he got back home, he plugged the air fresheners in, and the room immediately began to smell better. He went ahead and opened a window to let the room air out as well. He was just about to grab a fan to put into the window to speed up the process when he heard a key turning in the lock. He froze. Zoe wasn't supposed to be coming home till around midnight. She texted him and said she was working a double today. Honey, I'm home. Her voice trailed off as she entered the apartment with a grocery bag. Malachi stood still, feeling and probably looking as guilty as the day he was born. Malachi, what's going on? Why do you have that fan? What's with the air fresheners? And what is that horrible smell? The color drained from her face. No, Malachi's mind screamed. Baby, it's nothing, he said, trying to sound smooth and cover up the situation. I was just doing a little cleaning, that's all. He stepped toward her, but she stepped back. Why do we need air fresheners, though, Malachi? You never used them before when you cleaned. Malachi fought to keep control. I was just trying something new. If you don't like them, we can unplug them. He went toward one of the plug-ins and snatched it out of the wall for emphasis, hoping he didn't sound too eager for her to believe him. She stared at him, and Malachi didn't like the look in her eyes. Malachi, is there something you need to tell me? He chuckled like she was crazy. No, what are you talking about? She asked him point blank, did you have a woman in my house? Malachi grew serious. No, I would never do that. That part was actually true because he'd only slept with Shartasia and Aaron at their homes or in a hotel, and he hadn't had sex with Leah yet. Yet, his conscience sounded, but Malachi shook it off. He needed to focus on the matter at hand. He couldn't lose Zoe, not now, and not like this. Baby, what are you doing home so early? I took the rest of the day off to cook for you. Zoe shot back, her tone and expression stony. Malachi forced a smile. Wow, thank you, baby. What's crazy is that you and I had a similar idea. Zoe's nose wrinkled. What do you mean? Malachi spouted out the lie as naturally as he could and hoped it stuck. Well, I was thinking while I was at work today about what you said regarding your parents. I know you say they're always getting on you about not working for your father's company. I was thinking of cooking a dinner for him this weekend and inviting him over. We could break the news about us getting our own house with our own hard-earned money. Malachi swallowed as he internally willed Zoe to believe him. It wasn't hot in the room, seeing that the windows were open, but still he felt the sweat trickling down his back. Zoe looked like she was considering his words. Her expression softened slightly. So that's why you were doing all the cleaning and airing the house out, so they would have nothing negative to say about us? Malachi nodded. Yeah, you know, you say they're always talking about our apartment being so cramped and tiny and looking down on us. I figured if I got the place looking and smelling good, along with a nice down-home meal, they could see that we got this. Finally, Zoe seemed to relax, and Malachi relaxed with her. I guess that makes sense, she said. They were just going on the other day about us not inviting them over. See, this is great then, Malachi grinned. But Malachi, we haven't saved enough of the down payment yet. I don't want them to... Zoe looked worried. He stepped in immediately. Don't worry about that. We're very close to our goal, and they will have no choice but to see that. All of our hard work has been paying off, especially yours. Nobody should have nothing but respect for all we've done. Zoe finally smiled. I guess we'd better put together a menu then. And that's the end of that chapter. See? This is crazy. I don't like this nigga. Because he lying on the fly. Oh, that's a slick nigga there. When they can tell you a believable lie on the fly, yeah, that's the one you got to watch. Mm-mm-mm. I don't know. That depends. Because that was the end of that chapter, y'all. You decide how that works out. figure it out. Y'all ain't picked up the backyard in a minute. Mm-hmm. Yep. Let me see. I got my time stamp. We letting it count on down to the ground. She's talking about, let me just go get the bell. Girl, shut up. She's silly. All right. Chapter 13. Guilt was pummeling Malachi's psyche every day like a bad omen. He needed to make changes, and now his lies were becoming bigger and bigger. Pretty soon, he was going to get caught, especially with this Avenger person on his back. His mind flashed to Chartasia. Malachi was about 99% sure she was the one doing all this, since she had been acting out of character lately, but he had no proof. He understood that she wanted them to move forward with each other since they had a child together, but she had to know it wasn't that easy. He couldn't just leave Zoe like that. Plus, Chartasia was crazy. Did she honestly think he was going to want to be with her after she'd endangered his life twice? If Chartasia really was the one behind all this, Malachi wasn't so sure he wanted Makai around her either. Leaving notes in his work locker and vandalizing his car was one thing, but breaking into his home and putting a dead squirrel in his mailbox, not to mention extracting enough blood from the squirrel's body to... Malachi shuddered at that thought. If she was capable of mutilating an animal in such a way, who knew what she would do to him? He thought about confronting her face to face, but wasn't sure how much good it would do. All she had to do was deny it, then demand proof, and they would be back to square one. Oh, Malachi said to himself, calming his nerves for the nth time since all these crazy events started happening. He would just stick to his original plan, do right by Zoe, spend more time with his son, and stop sleeping with Chartasia to create more of a boundary there. As for Leia and Aaron, he still wasn't quite sure how he was going to. Malachi's entire body tensed once again, but for a different reason. Speak of the devil and he shall arrive, he said to himself. Before he could think straight, Malachi was exiting his vehicle, which he had parked in front of a grocery store. He was heading there to pick up the food items he'd allegedly been planning to cook for the dinner with Zoe's parents. His mind was no longer on those groceries, however, or his other problems. His eyes were on Banks. Hey! He barked, causing Banks to turn in the direction of his voice. At that moment, Malachi realized he was outnumbered since Banks had two of his boys with him, but he didn't care. Can I help you? Banks said with a smirk, like he already knew why Malachi was addressing him. Malachi cut straight to the chase. You put your hands on Aaron? He stepped to Banks, ready for whatever, until he heard a gun cock on his left side. He maintained his composure, though he definitely wasn't trying to lose his life at the moment. Right, especially for a bitch that he wouldn't be getting no pussy over. Anyway, he crazy. Banks' smirk turned into a grin. Oh, excuse me, he clapped his hands. It looks like somebody trying to be a superhero. That's a mighty bold move you just made, trash man. Where is she? Why does it matter to you? Where is she? Malachi repeated. I swear, if you hurt her, what you gonna do, pussy? Banks said, spreading his arms, and Malachi lunged for him. It was a dumb move, seeing that he was not only outnumbered, but he had no weapon except his blade, but he didn't care. All he could think of was that bruise on Aaron's face. Malachi was getting the best of Banks before Banks's boys jumped in and easily got him to the ground, stomping him a few times before pulling out their guns and pointing them at his face. Luckily for them, but not for Malachi, no one was in the parking lot of the grocery store besides the men and a couple of other cars. Malachi glared up at Banks, ready to die for his woman. She is not your woman, sir. Clearly, she belongs to this big nigga and quite possibly the two goons with him, okay? But you? Yeah, no, she don't know you. And she's sorry to that man. Stupid ass. Anyway, you touch her again, I'll fucking kill you. Banks spat blood from his mouth, then laughed. You seem to be just as delusional as that bitch. How you think you gonna do anything with two guns pointed at your head? Don't you see we can end you right now? Do it then, Malachi said. Oh, this nigga's a dummy, y'all. He's a dummy. He got a whole son and a bitch at the crib that's willing to work doubles and lose sleep for his ass. And he fighting over a bitch that don't even belong to him. And gon' die. One of Banks' boys cocked his gun, ready to shoot, but Banks held him back as another car pulled into the parking lot. Nah, it ain't time for that yet. He looked down at Malachi. Take this as a warning. You're barking up the wrong tree, nigga. I understand you and Aaron was high school sweethearts or some bullshit like that, but I own that bitch now. Step to me again and I won't be as accommodating. Nigga, spell accommodating. Your name Banks and you the dope man. Fuck out of here. Accommodating. An older gentleman got out of the car that just pulled up and started shouting, "Hey, put those guns away. I'm calling the police." He whipped out his phone and began dialing. Banks curled his lip up at him. "Mind your fucking business, old timer. We were just leaving." With those words, they left, piling back into Banks' vehicle and peeling off. Malachi felt like a damn fool. His confrontation with Banks had not only accomplished nothing, but he almost lost his life and probably endangered Aaron even more. Right. He finna go home and rock her snot box thanks to your shenanigans, dummy. Ugh, just a loser ass nigga. He should have fucking... Anyway, he returned to his feet and stared into space. Yeah, you are. You should be staring into space because you a fucking space cadet, dummy. Young man, are you okay? The old man asked him. Malachi just nodded, not in the mood for a full conversation at the moment. Thankfully, the old man put his phone away instead of calling the police once Banks and his boys left, so Malachi wouldn't have to explain the incident to Zoe later. He went to a gas station bathroom to check his appearance, and thankfully, there wasn't any swelling or bleeding since Banks' boys had mostly hit him with body shots. Malachi purchased another white tee to replace the one he'd gotten dirty during the scuffle, then hurried to a different grocery store so Zoe wouldn't grow suspicious. As he drove back to their apartment, his mind went back to Aaron. He had to find her. He had to get her away from Banks. "Sir, mind your business. If that girl wanted to be away from Banks, she'd find a way. That ain't none of your business." Lord have mercy. Y'all be thinking y'all got a good man because he the trash man and he got good government benefits. But he a whole bald-headed hoe out here. A whole mess. Chapter 14. Under normal circumstances, Malachi would have been nervous about dinner with Zoe's parents, but all the stress he was under lately caused him not to give a damn what they thought of him. He loved their daughter point blank. There was nothing they could do about that. "Mommy, Daddy," Zoe greeted her parents with a smile after she opened the front door to her and Malachi's apartment. Pause. That's the problem. They don't want him to marry her. Because he a trash man. Because he acting like they going to stop them from buying a home. Like, what the fuck can they do? If they got their own fucking money and their own credit, what the hell can her parents do? Like, duh. Malachi was standing at her side, so he watched as she hugged and kissed them both. Zoe's mother, Zelda, gave Malachi a fake half hug, which sent the message loud and clear that she still disapproved of him. And her father, Xander, gave him a stern look as he shook his hand. Malachi ignored their cold gestures, praying this night would go smoothly or at least end quickly. Oh, that's right. They know that he fucked around on her to get Makai. So, yeah, they mad. Yeah, fuck him. No, Ben ain't the trash man. Malachi is. He make more money than both of them. Yeah. The roast was sizzling and had just come out of the oven. The mixed veggies were caramelized and sitting on the stove, and the garlic mashed potatoes had been made to perfection. If Malachi was good at one thing, it was cooking. Alice had taught him well. From the looks on Zoe's parents' faces, however, his hard work in the kitchen was about to amount to nothing. At Zoe's behest, Malachi had gone against his better judgment and purchased a $250 bottle of Cabernet, along with a bucket and ice to chill it. Zelda scrunched up her nose at the sight of the bottle sitting in the middle of the table in the ice bucket. "That cheap thing," she commented. Malachi gritted his teeth but said nothing. He shot a glance at Zoe, but she appeared to be letting the comment roll off her shoulders. She gestured toward two seats at opposite sides of the table. "Mom, Dad, please sit." Malachi was about to chuckle at her formal tone when he saw Xander assume the position at the head of the table, completely ignoring Zoe's gesture, and her mother did the same, sitting at the other end. Again, Malachi shrugged off their rudeness. He clapped once and said, "All right, let's get this party started," then disappeared into the kitchen to fix the plates. Zoe followed closely behind him. "Child, you better follow, because the way I would have been sprinkling fucking rat poison like goddamn salt all over they shit." Somebody better watch me in the kitchen while I fix the place, because you motherfuckers. Oh, I got something for you right underneath that goddamn kitchen cabinet in there. Keep on playing around that part. When they were out of earshot, Zoe whispered to Malachi with a half smile, "Don't mind them. You're doing great." Malachi returned the gesture. "Am I? Your mom called that expensive ass wine cheap." Zoe rolled her eyes. "Don't mind her. That's how she shows she's impressed." Malachi blinked at that comment, then helped to fix the plates. When all the food was on the table, they bowed their heads while Xander gave a prayer. As soon as their heads were lifted, Xander started in on Malachi. "So, Malachi, have you begun applying for a better job yet? I know you must be tired of my daughter making more money than you." Malachi played it cool, knowing that Xander only asked the question to push his buttons. He'd already told Zoe's father several times since meeting him that his job as a sanitation engineer paid him a good salary. And being at the senior level, he was essentially set in terms of his retirement plan. On top of that, he actually made more money than Zoe, but he wasn't about to show Xander his paycheck. "Dad," Zoe warned. Xander cut his eyes at his daughter. "What? I asked the man a question. Let him speak for himself." Zelda cut in. "Doesn't the smell bother you at all?" Malachi felt himself growing hot, but he maintained his composure. "Mrs. Rivers, as I explained before, a garbage collector and a sanitation engineer are two different positions. I oversee operations and promote safety. I'm very proud of how far my degree has taken me." Zelda's face reddened with what looked like embarrassment, and it must have pissed Xander off because he cut back in. "So, you stand around watching people pick up trash and telling them where to put it. I don't care what kind of fancy name you attach to it. Picking up trash doesn't take a degree. Our parents teach us to clean up behind ourselves from childhood. Or at least some of them do." Malachi had enough. He was about to lay into Zoe's father, then escort him from the apartment, but Zoe cut in. "Mom, Dad, Malachi and I actually invited you over because we have an announcement to make." Malachi gave her a look to stop talking, but she continued, "We're excited to announce that we're buying a house." She clapped her hands for emphasis, but no one in the room shared in the celebratory moment. Xander looked even more pissed now. Again, he ignored Zoe and kept his attention on Malachi. "So you're buying a house before even asking for my daughter's hand in marriage? Are you planning to marry her?" "Sir, we're..." Malachi started, but Zoe cut in. "Daddy, that's so old-fashioned. Malachi doesn't need your permission to marry me. Besides, that's not what this conversation is about. Aren't you happy for us?" She looked at Zelda for moral support, then pulled her phone out of the back pocket of her jeans. "Mommy, let me show you some of the houses I've been looking at." Malachi decided to tune out both of Zoe's parents for the rest of the evening. He got that he didn't come from prestige, had grown up in a single-parent home, and wasn't making over six figures with the position he was working. On the flip side, he busted his ass to get to the senior level at his company, especially as a young Black man, and he wasn't letting anyone take the credit from him. Sooner or later, Zoe's parents were going to have to back off, or Malachi would need to have a discussion with her about how they were going to move forward as a couple. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, he real fucking disrespectful to his daughter. I mean, fuck her nigga. I'm talking about to her daughter, to his daughter. Like, it's like he don't even give a damn. You know what I'm saying? Oh, shit. Okay. I got my timestamp. All right. So we're going to let that count down. But I need a little intermission here. So listen, y'all. Over the weekend, I was in the process of trying to watch a scary movie. Y'all know I told y'all that I don't be watching scary movies, but I told y'all that every once in a while, I will, you know, be like, "Hey, shut up, Peanut." Every once in a while, I would be like, "Hey, you know, I feel like watching a scary movie or whatever," right? I'm on the phone with my fucking sister. We tried to pick a fucking movie, and she talk about, not that one. It's a movie about, I think It's a new movie out. It's called, what is it? The First Omen, I think it is. I really want to see it, like, in the daytime, like 9, 10 o'clock in the morning. I told y'all how I had to do it, right? Because listen, oh my God. And then it's this other movie called Cuckoo. Oh my God. I think that's supposed to be on, did that thing say it was on, wait, was it on Paramount or AMC? Or, I don't know where it's at, but I'm going to find it. But Love Jones is like, uh-uh, not that one, uh-uh. I'm like, girl. Oh my God. But I want something scary. I don't know why. I just feel like, you know, jumping a little bit with some popcorn, but y'all listen. So yeah, I just felt like I wanted to share that with y'all. I don't know if anybody maybe done been to the show to see that movie. Perhaps. Do y'all watch the scary flicks? The scary flickerizations of it all? I just as a child, you know, was kind of fascinated, you know, with the Damien Omen movies, you know? So like, this is supposed to be like the first Omen, and I don't know how it's going to work, but according to the damn, the trailer, y'all, I want to see it. And the way my sleep has been set up lately, hell, I could watch it at night. I'd be up all goddamn night anyway. Oh Lord, shout Mr. Nigga, go to bed and wake back up and I'm still up. Yeah. Tell my job, I just got one more load of laundry and then and then I'ma stop. Yeah. That don't work. But anyway, hey Buns, welcome. Thank you for being here. Hey Danielle. Hey girl, hey. I appreciate you both being here, ladies. Welcome. With y'all late asses. Y'all late. But that's all right. I'm going to stop talking and get back to the book. But has anybody seen that movie? I just want to know. Oh, wait, I missed somebody. Who else I miss? There you go. I thought I saw you. Miss twerking behind a tree. Uh-huh. Hey, church lady. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Yeah. We don't forget shit around here. Mm. You say you're a horror. Oh my God. Oh Lord. Wifey. No, ma'am. So Danielle said, I ain't watching nothing scary unless it's during the day. And then I got headphones in one ear with gospel music playing during the scary parts. What the fuck is the gospel music supposed to do, girl? Oh, Lord have mercy. You think that's going to stop them from getting you, Danielle? No, ma'am. I'm here to tell you, it ain't gonna work, boo. It ain't gonna work. Mm-mm. No, no, and hell no. Oh, my God. Right. That's what I went. I had to put folks out of my... Aw. That's to stay from behind that tree. So, Sad said, I love scary movies at any time. Oh, my God. You one of them? Oh, my God. Child, uh-uh. Said he said, I can't, child. It's got to be up in the daytime early so I can watch a bunch of comedy after. So, yeah. Oh, that's what it was. So she had a blunt talking about it's a sausage. Yeah, all right. If that's what you got to tell yourself. But the Lord, okay. I told you, bullet train to hell. Mm-mm-mm. I ain't got nothing to do with that, ma'am. You's grown. Good and grown. All right, let me get back to the book. Lord have mercy. Because, we about to get out of here in a minute. Chapter 15. Malachi's alarm sounded to wake him up for work, but he didn't feel like going in. He was tempted to call out, but decided against it. Xander and Zelda's attitudes had pretty much ruined his weekend. Normally, he let people's comments about the type of work he did roll off his shoulders because, in his eyes, as long as what he was doing was legitimate, it shouldn't matter. The money was still green and it paid all his bills. His phone buzzed on the nightstand, causing him to groan, then reach out for it. He glanced over at Zoe's side of the bed, but of course, she was long gone to work by now. Malachi chuckled. That woman had energy for days. He licked his lips as he thought of how she had put it on him the previous night. Zoe had sensed he was down in the dumps over all the recent happenings, or at least the ones she knew about. So she catered to him in every way she could. Malachi couldn't have asked for a better woman. He was counting down the days to when he would finally ask her to be his wife. Zoe was a special woman, so Malachi wanted everything to be perfect when he popped the question. He was in the planning phase for the venue, who would be invited, and whether or not he would have it captured on video. Would that be more superficial or sentimental? He asked himself. He pondered it a moment, then shook his head, deciding it really didn't matter. Zoe would see his heart as well as his devotion toward her. Guilt rose within him as he thought of how he'd always wanted Aaron to be his wife, but he couldn't dwell on that right now. Zoe was his woman, not Aaron. Aaron was with Banks. She doesn't want to be, though. Malachi refocused yet again and swiped his screen to read the text that had come through a few minutes ago. "I will kill you, motherfucker," it read in all caps. Of course, it was from a private number. Malachi sucked his teeth. This Avenger person had way too much time on their hands. He had half a mind to call Chartasia right then. He was almost certain it was her this time. He had seen her briefly when he went to his mother's house to pick up Makai Saturday. They had a conversation where he told her in no uncertain terms that he wanted their interactions moving forward to be totally about Makai and nothing else. Chartasia had cocked her head when he said that, giving him a curious-looking side eye. Mm-hmm. Okay. She acted unbothered after that and left, but Malachi had a feeling she wouldn't let up too easily. Now, here he was with this random-ass text message. Pause, let me tell you something. You can't send a fucking private text message. Yeah, that doesn't work. Yeah, you can't do that. So I guess that's where we suspend disbelief. All right, here we go. His screen had gone black because of inactivity, so Malachi decided to call Chartasia out through text. He swiped his screen again, prepared to screenshot the message and send it to Chartasia, letting her know he was on to her, but the message was gone. What the heck? Did I delete it? He said, squinting his eyes and rolling his inbox. He checked all of his threads carefully, but the message was gone. He went to his deleted text folder. Maybe he'd accidentally deleted it without realizing it. Nope, it wasn't there either. He said to himself. There was something strange about a text message popping up on a person's phone, then just disappearing out of nowhere. Maybe I'm just bugging. He knew he wasn't, though. He'd seen what he'd seen. He just couldn't explain it. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Oh, my God, today. Y'all, what is gonna happen to this fool? Because he is dumb. He still ain't got a hint. I guess that's what the deal is. This fool has no clue what the hell. And he over here just freeballing it. Dumbass. Oh, well. I guess he'll learn one way or another. We'll see in a minute. Chapter 16. Malachi thought about that text message off and on throughout the day at work and eventually decided to let it go. Maybe that was Chartasia's last dig at him before she finally moved on from the idea of them getting back together. He couldn't shake his growing concern over her mental health, though. She demonstrated dangerous and erratic behavior lately, and those recent incidents only made things seem worse. He contemplated calling her and telling her he wanted to have another conversation, but he didn't know how much good it would do. She'd acted completely unbothered by the fact that he told her he no longer wanted to sleep with her, despite the fact that she damn near killed them both less than 2 weeks prior on the day of Makai's parent-teacher conference when he turned down her proposal to work it out. "I'll just see if she does something else," he said to himself. "This is he that type of dude, stupid." Buck said, "I suspended disbelief in the very beginning when Buddy said he won the poker game with five of a kind." "Ah, shit. I saw your ass say, what type of cards he playing with?" Oh my God. Listen. Oh man. Oh hell no. Buck, your ass crazy. He said, "Yeah, I been done did that, auntie." The nigga said five of a kind. Like, for real? It's only four suits in the damn deck. Two black and two red. Where the fifth one coming from? Oh, Lord. Anyway, here we go. Maybe that's that weird combo. Oh, my God. All right. At the end of Malachi's shift, he was exhausted, to say the least. He'd had three different meetings that day, and each had lasted over 2 hours. He wanted nothing more than to go home and go to sleep. When he entered his vehicle, he completed his daily ritual of turning his phone on to see if he had any missed messages or voicemails. It turned out he had 65, all from different numbers. "What the hell is this?" Malachi scrunched up his nose as he scrolled through the various random phone numbers. There were all kinds of photos of dead animals, crime scenes, and threatening messages. He stopped short when he opened one of the messages and saw that it was an image of a mutilated dead body with his face photoshopped onto the victim's. It looked so authentic, it made him sick to his stomach. "Fuck this shit, I'm going to the cops." Malachi had never thought of getting the police involved with any of Shartasia's previous shenanigans, not even when she'd run him down with her car years ago after finding out he cheated. He told the police that the accident happened so fast he never saw the driver and couldn't make out the license plate of the vehicle. When they asked for the make and model, he gave them a bogus made-up answer. Needless to say, they never found the person responsible for sending him to the hospital for over a week. Shartasia never even apologized because the bitch is crazy. What are you thinking, sir? Cornbread raw, just mixed in a bowl. That's it. Minus the fucking egg. Shartasia never even apologized. Not that Malachi held it against her, because he knew exactly why she did it. Her behavior was extreme, but he decided to take it as an L since he'd broken her heart. "And this is how she does me?" Malachi was fuming as he pulled into the parking lot of the local police station. It was only minutes from his job, so he barely had enough time to think about what he was going to say to him. He figured if he showed them the messages, that should be enough to at least get a restraining order on her ass. After that, if she kept up her bullshit, he would file for custody of Makai. That would humble her real quick. Not that he would ever want to take his son from his mother, especially seeing that they had an excellent relationship from what Malachi knew. But still, Shartasia needed to learn self-control. Malachi hopped out of his vehicle, then paused. He wanted to at least get screenshots of the messages in case they somehow magically erased like that first one did. Pulled out his phone and swiped the screen, going straight to his inbox. Of course, all of the messages were gone. "Damn," he grunted, pissed that he hadn't thought of the screenshot idea sooner. "How the hell is she controlling my phone like this?" Another message came through from a private number. "Not so fast, motherfucker," was all it said. Then it disappeared too. Not that it mattered, because with no actual threat or connection to a threat, he couldn't show it to the police. But wait, how did they know I was... Malachi whipped his head to the left, then the right. There were no familiar vehicles around him to indicate he was being followed. There were no passers-by who looked suspicious. This Avenger person was getting in his head, and he didn't like it. "Maybe I should look into getting a gun," he pondered. Then he thought of Shartasia again and sucked his teeth. He hopped in his whip and sped toward her apartment, not giving a damn that he was peeling out of a police station parking lot like he'd lost his mind. And that's the end of that chapter. Y'all, listen. I don't know. Like, I'm tripping. Oh, child. You said, I don't think it's her. I think that girl daddy messing with him. Buck said, I don't think it's her. The Avenger, a pretty decent hacker. ShamWow don't say that. Not ShamWow. Her name is Shartasia. First cousin of Khadijah. Oh, Lord. You done call that damn girl ShamWow. Okay, Seti said, thanks for being here. Good night. Why the fuck am I waving like you can see me? See, that just shows how totally and thoroughly immersed in the speakeasy I be sitting up here with y'all. Totally gone. That's why they able to come around the fucking corner and have me jumping out of my goddamn skin and shit. That's how. Now y'all know. All right, here we go, y'all. Chapter 17. Malachi was 2 minutes from Shartasia's house when his dashboard sounded with a call from hospice. His heart dropped. Marcus, his mind told him, but Malachi didn't want to think about that right now. All he wanted to do was go over to Shartasia's house, set her ass straight, and go home. He knew he couldn't miss this call, though. He answered before the ring ran out. Hello? Marcus's doctor was on the other line. Malachi? Malachi swallowed. He could tell from the sound of her voice that she was about to tell him. Yes, it's me, he finally managed. I have some news about your father. Can you come in? Malachi gripped the steering wheel full of raw emotion. A panic attack was threatening to rise up, but he hadn't had one of those since his teenage years. He refused to let anxiety get the best of him now. Is he gone? He said in the calmest voice he could muster. Malachi, it's best if we discuss this in person. Is my father gone? He repeated in a louder and more forceful tone. Dr. Jacobs took a breath. Yes, he is. I know you wanted to. Malachi hung up the phone. His entire body went numb. He hadn't even remembered pulling over to the side of the road to take the call. He couldn't see in front of him. He couldn't hear. He could barely breathe. Dr. Jacobs had really just told him that Marcus was gone, dead. No chance for a comeback. No opportunity to pray for his healing. No possibility of genuine reconciliation. A life wasted and a potential relationship forever lost. Malachi sat there on the side of the road until the sky began to darken. Then he took the long route to the hospice center. Man, I don't know why he tweaking over his raggedy-ass, absentee-ass father. Like, nigga, you can't miss what you never had. Fuck was you busting up there like the nigga gave a fuck about you. He just figured you'd be the only dumb motherfucker stupid enough to put his ass in the ground. You see, his other fucking chillin' ain't been up there. Cause why? They don't give a fuck. Fuck that nigga. That's what they said. They said that about him because he said that about them. Oh, and newsflash, he said that about you too. So you worrying yourself to death over a nigga who didn't give a fizzledy fuck about you. Hell, damn dummy. When he got there, everything was a blur. They asked if he wanted to see his father, and he said he did, but he didn't know why he said that. No, he didn't want to see Marcus that way. Despite the hatred Malachi harbored toward Marcus for most of his life, he never would have wished death on the man, especially not the type of death that killed him slowly, sapping all of his strength before taking his final breaths. Malachi stood by the bed in the same position with the same numb feeling, staring at his father until Dr. Jacobs finally asked if there was anyone who could come to be with him during this time. His first thought was to call his mother, but he didn't know how he would respond if she made any type of negative comment. It was true. Marcus wasn't shit, but that was still his father. See, that's what's wrong with the black community. That's still your father. That's still your mother, bitch. So? What do you mean? So? I'm still his child, and he still ain't do shit, so why the fuck should I? Because he's sick? Or in the words of Alonzo from Training Day, because he knows my first name? Shit, that don't make him my friend, and it damn sure don't make him my father. And I know for fucking certain that it don't make him my goddamn responsibility. The shit works in the opposite direction. Hell, he didn't reach out to me until he was damn near dead. Half dead motherfucker. Well, now he fully dead, but still, he was half dead when he reached out to him. Hell. Anyway, he called Zoe instead, then hung up before she could answer and text her. Marcus is gone, was all his fingers afforded him the strength to type. Zoe showed up about an hour later looking flustered in her work uniform. Malachi, she said, her face streaked with tears as she burst in the room. Baby, are you okay? I'm so sorry it took me so long. I tried to leave as soon as I... She stopped when she saw that all of her words fell on deaf ears. Malachi was in a state of shock. Nothing registered. Nothing mattered. Zoe stared between Marcus on the bed and the vacant look in Malachi's eyes. She stepped beside her man and intertwined her fingers with his. Baby, we're going to get through this, okay? Translation. I'ma still work double shifts at my motherfucking job while I plan your raggedy ass daddy's funeral. While you sit on your ass and do what? Sulk like a little ass boy? Hell no. You on your own. Put your dead ass sperm donor in the garbage. Shit. Cause I ain't gonna be able to do it. We ain't getting through a motherfucking thing. I don't know that nigga. Hell, truth be told, neither do you. Fuck, we about to stress ourselves out planning something for this nigga. Yeah. Let me see here. I'm trying to get this timestamp. Hell, nigga didn't give a free fuck on the fourth Friday in February about your ass. Hell, and you sitting up here telling my dad died. Man, fuck that nigga. He wasn't your dad. He was a goddamn sperm donor. That's what the fuck he was. Mm-mm. I'll stop telling folks, oh, you know, that's still your mother, your father, your sister, your brother. I wouldn't give a fuck. No. Mm-mm. No? Hell no. All the more reason why they should fucking know better while they running around doing damage to me. But I'm supposed to take it easy on them? I think the fuck not. No. Chapter 18. Zoe drove Malachi home, then called Ben, Zaire, and Malachi's mother, Alice, and told them what happened. Alice came immediately. Zaire and Ben came at first, then went to the hospice center to pick up Malachi's vehicle. Ben drove it back while Zaire followed. At first, everyone sat in silence. Then Alice went into the kitchen to start cooking. Malachi was sitting on the couch with the same blank expression he'd been wearing since he heard the news, while Zoe sat next to him holding his hand, and Ben and Zaire sat on the love seat. Baby, we're going to get through this, Zoe kept saying. Malachi stared straight ahead. She's right, bro. We just got to take it one day at a time. We'll help with all the arrangements, Ben offered. Malachi still wasn't responding, so Zoe flipped on the TV to turn it to the sports highlights. Then she went to the kitchen to help Alice, while Zaire and Ben continued to console Malachi. Hey, man, at least this is an opportunity to taste some more of your mom's legendary cooking, Zaire said. In a lighthearted tone, his eyes twinkling, smells like her and Zoe are killing it in there. Right, Ben said with a chuckle. Fuck, hold on, y'all. Malachi still wasn't budging, so Ben walked over and sat next to him on the couch. He put his arm around Malachi's shoulder. Come on, bro, we know you're going through it, but you gotta say something. You gotta let it out. For the first time, Malachi showed an indication he was hearing what his friends were saying. He knew Ben's words were genuine since he'd lost his own dad a few years ago. That had been the worst time in Ben's life, and Malachi and Zaire had stuck with him every step of the way. I just can't believe it, man, Malachi said. His eyes filled up, but he blinked back his emotion. I couldn't believe it either when it happened to me, but you just gotta take it one day at a time. Ben's tone was firm but comforting. Malachi could only shake his head in response. Zaire was staring at him. He opened his mouth to say something, but Zoe walked into the room carrying a tray of drinks. She handed one to Malachi first. One whiff of it, and Malachi could tell Zoe had filled his cup with something strong. Thank you, Ben said, when Zoe handed him his drink. What's this? Zaire asked when Zoe gave him his. Zoe smirked and winked. Just a little something I put together. Zaire took a sip and scrunched his face as the powerful liquid blazed a trail down his throat. Damn, Zoe. Malachi's about to be down for the count and me and Ben might need an Uber. We've got to let out couch, was her response before heading back into the kitchen. Malachi downed his drink, completely ignoring the brain freeze that the iced beverage was giving him. If whatever Zoe had concocted was going to put him to sleep, as Zaire suggested, he was all in. He didn't want to feel anymore. He didn't want to be. He appreciated the love and support everyone was showing him, but nothing they said could alleviate what he was going through. And that's the end of that chapter. He taking on some shit that ain't his responsibility, but he's only doing it because he's in the middle of, you know, the entirety of his life basically crumbling around him. He got some weird motherfucker after him, right? They got a hard on for him. And, Yeah. You know, his absentee father dies, making him permanently absent. And not Zorro, ready to get the whole house drunk. Shit, let me pour me a drink. Oh, Lord. I'm mad. Her name is Zoe, goddammit. But yeah, I don't... I just feel like, you know, he taking it super hard because he's choosing to. And I feel like that's not beneficial for him. Yeah, he's got some shit to work through, but young man, that nigga was not your responsibility. And yeah, you fucked up like him, but still, you got time left to fix your shit. Mm-mm. That's the problem. He's not seeing that. He's missing that part. Completely. Chapter 19. Malachi's eyes popped open the next morning when he heard a sound. He whipped his head towards Zoe, but she wasn't in bed next to him. "The fuck?" he said, then got up and went to the bathroom, but she wasn't there either. He went to their bedroom window to look outside and saw Ben's car, but Zoe, Alice, and Zaire's cars were gone. "What the fuck?" Malachi repeated. He went downstairs to the kitchen to see Ben warming up a plate in the microwave. "Hey, bro," Ben said. "My bad. Did I wake you? How'd you sleep?" Malachi chose not to answer his questions. "Where's Zoe?" he asked instead. Ben paused. "Oh, well, she left out earlier because she had to work, but Zaire should be on his way back from the store soon. He wanted to get us some more liquor for today." Malachi was pissed beyond belief. "Nah, I'm good," he said, waving off Ben's offer to chill. "What do you mean?" Ben gave him a curious look. "Y'all don't need to stay here with me. I gotta go to work myself." Ben stared for a second. "Malachi," he began, but a knock on the front door interrupted him. Malachi went to answer it, and Zaire walked in, grinning with two brown paper bags filled with drinks. "We about to turn this motherfucker out," he said. "Chill, man. I gotta go to work," Malachi said, urging him to go back out the door. "Go to work?" Zaire said. "Nigga, you won't believe me. Call them and tell them you need at least a week." "Malachi, Zaire's right. The last place you need to be is work right now." Malachi wasn't budging from his stance. "I have an important meeting. I'll tell him about the bereavement at the end of my shift." Both of his friends protested, but Malachi refused to listen. He practically forced them out of his apartment, then got in the shower, took a few Tylenol to silence his booming headache, and went to work. Of course, when he got there, he accomplished nothing. His boss, Julio, noticed something was wrong and asked him what was up. He admitted that his father died. "Damn, Malachi, take the rest of the week off. We'll see you Monday," Julio said. Now he was forced out of work, so all Malachi had was time to sit at home and twiddle his thumbs. Zoe had pissed him clean off by going to work without even trying to wake him up and ask him if he was okay with that. He stewed in his emotions for a few moments, then rationalized that he was just taking his anger out on her. It was messed up that she had gone to work on a day like this, but it wasn't her fault that Marcus had passed. He would forgive her. She probably wasn't thinking. Besides, he had ignored all of her attempts to console him the day prior. Maybe he hurt her feelings. But does that mean she should just... A call from Chartasia interrupted his thoughts. "Hello? Malachi, listen. Your mom called me this morning, so I know you're going through it about your father, which is why you never answered my calls yesterday, but I'm really scared." Malachi had just pulled up to his apartment. "Scared of what?" Chartasia's voice got shaky. "Malachi, somebody tried to lure Makai to sneak out last night." "Lure Makai to sneak out? Fuck you mean?" "I heard something in the kitchen after 11 in the evening, so I went downstairs to see what was going on. Makai was trying to get out the back door without me knowing." "Why the hell was he doing that?" "He wouldn't tell me at first, but I forced it out of him. Apparently, some girl was supposedly messaging his tablet, telling him she liked him and wanted him to meet her at the park. I didn't believe that shit for a second. The messages looked suspicious as fuck, Malachi. Just the way they were worded, I could tell it was some creep trying to..." Chartasia took a deep breath, trying to calm herself. Malachi felt himself growing heated. This shit had gone too far. "Are you at home? Where's Makai?" "He's right here. We're at home. I kept him from school because..." For the first time since Malachi had met her, Chartasia sounded like she was close to tears. He floored it to her house the whole way, trying to piece together what the hell was going on. Apparently, Chartasia wasn't the Avenger like he thought. There was no way she would do something like this to her own son. She answered the door, looking as shaky as her voice had sounded on the phone. "Where is he?" "He's in his room." "Makai!" Malachi's voice thundered through the house. Micaiah came running. Yes, he said, looking like he already knew what was up. Who is this person your mother told me about? Micaiah looked at Shartasia before responding. It's a girl. A girl from where? Malachi shot back. Micaiah looked embarrassed, but it wasn't time for that right now. A girl from where, Micaiah? Malachi repeated. Micaiah swallowed. She's from another school, okay? Let me see your tablet. Shartasia went to her purse and pulled it out. He's not getting this thing back anytime soon. I want to take it to the police to see if we can find this person. Mommy, no, she's my friend, Micaiah protested. Malachi scrolled through the messages and immediately agreed with Shartasia's assessment. The wording of the messages was a dead giveaway that it wasn't another kid writing to Micaiah. Malachi glared at his son, ready to lay into him for being stupid enough to fall for something so obvious, but he stopped himself. Who the hell was he to come out of nowhere with this type of discipline? He was Makai's father. He should have been teaching his son about predators all along instead of leaving it to his mother. It finally dawned on him what Shartasia was talking about that day in the car. He'd brushed off her idea about them trying to work things out for Makai's sake, but now he fully understood. He was supposed to be his son's protector, and he'd been fucking up, just like Marcus did him. Malachi's heart burned at the thought of Marcus. He shook his head to push away the memory of what happened yesterday. He'd have to find time to grieve later. Now it was time to make sure his son was safe. Get your shoes on, Malachi ordered. For what? Micaiah asked. Do what I said. Malachi boomed, and Micaiah took off for his room. This shit is crazy, Tay, Malachi said to Shartasia. She had been staring at him during his whole interaction with Micaiah. Malachi, are you okay? She asked. She could tell, or sorry, he could tell, she was being genuine, but he'd already messed up enough in their relationship by giving her mixed signals. He didn't want to let his guard down and get vulnerable with her, only to end up back where he was before. I'm good, he said. Sorry, child. I thought it was a fucking spider on me. Lord have mercy. I'm gonna beat your ass. Here we go. Toenail tea. Okay. Anyway, Micaiah came back with his shoes on and Malachi drove him and Shartasia to the police station. When they got there, Malachi and Shartasia were going over what they planned to say to the cops, but Shartasia stopped short, staring at the tablet screen. Malachi, what did you do? She asked, her tone frantic. What do you mean, what did I do? Did you press delete? No, why would I do that? She stared at him, then showed him the screen. The messages are gone. Malachi stared at the screen and saw that she was right. This mother... he started, but Shartasia cut him off. Why the hell would you delete the messages, Malachi? Now how are we going to find out who tried to mess with my baby? I didn't delete the messages, Shartasia. Yeah? How are they gone then? They didn't just magically disappear. Malachi opened his mouth to say that that was exactly what had happened, but he stopped himself. How was he going to explain that one? He decided to redirect the conversation. Listen, let's just make sure we keep a close eye on the situation going forward. He looked in his rearview mirror at Micaiah in the back seat. Micaiah, don't you ever talk to somebody you don't know again, okay? Yes, Micaiah said in a small voice. We need to bring that tablet in there and see if they can find a way to retrieve the messages or something, Shartasia said. I'm not playing no games about this. Shartasia, chill, Malachi said. There's no need to do that. Hell, if there isn't, she said, then snatched the tablet and got out of the car. She stalked toward the building and Malachi and Micaiah followed. I'm mad that he didn't think to fucking, to screenshot the shit. Like, he's so goddamn dumb. This nigga's a fucking idiot, man. Why did he be laying down with fucking dummies? Oh, educated dummies at that. Malachi was pissed, but at the same time, he knew Shartasia was doing the right thing. He didn't want to let on about all that had been happening lately, but he did want his son protected. The police had tons of questions for the three of them, and it took hours. Malachi didn't tell them anything about the messages he's been receiving and how they had disappeared, just like the ones that were sent to Micaiah. Shartasia kept staring at him through the whole conversation, though, and it made him suspicious of her all over again. She kept looking at him like she knew something he didn't know, and Malachi didn't like that. He didn't want to come out and question her about it in front of the cops, however. He had way too much on his mind to blow up on her in front of the cops. In the end, the police held on to Makai's tablet for processing to see if they could pull up the messages and find out who sent them. one more thing for Malachi to worry about. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, y'all. I'm out of here in 13 minutes. All right, let me get this next tabs down. I'm just telling y'all. Oh, you think, well, shit, he could have fucking emailed them to himself. That's what I would have done. Take the screenshot and email it to yourself. They can't get in his email. You know? Not bad as fuck. Ah, shit. Listen. Skillets. Y'all better get some skillets, goddammit. I promise you. Being there talking to yourself. Swing, bada, bada. No, don't be abusing your kids. Mm-mm. But yeah, discipline starts early, though. Kids need to learn that there's consequences for their actions. And you can't be no fucking punk about it either. You got to be, you know, firm. Yeah. Yeah, some of y'all be scared to do that. Be firm. All right. Here we go. Chapter 20. Malachi was on his first official day home since he'd left work early the previous day. Zoe asked if he wanted her to stay home with him, but he urged her to go to work. He wasn't sure why he did that. He'd been so pissed at her yesterday when she left without telling him, and then when she did tell him, he let her go. He dropped his head in his hands. Some shit had to shake, and soon. A notification buzzed on his phone, disrupting his thoughts. He swiped the screen, fully prepared to see yet another message from the Avenger or something. But no, it was an email from his job. They ran a monthly raffle where every employee got some kind of prize from one of the company's various sponsors, and some of the prizes were really nice. Malachi usually won small things like $5 gift cards and gas cards, but he'd heard of other guys winning cruises and other large prizes. The company gave out at least 3 large prizes each month. To Malachi's surprise, he was a big winner this time. He couldn't believe his eyes. Congratulations, you have won an all-expense-paid trip to Jamaica, he read as his eyes scanned the screen. Damn, a trip to Jamaica might be just what he needed. He'd been wanting to go away for a while, but he didn't want to ask Zoe because he knew she'd be stressed about them spending money. But this trip is paid for, though. He pondered it. Malachi barely ever took time off work, so taking another week after his bereavement wouldn't make any kind of waves with his boss. He was sure of it. At the same time, with everything going on with the Avenger, did he really want to leave town? They'd already come after Makai once. What made him think they wouldn't try his son again? Makai was a good kid, and Shartasia had taken his tablet, but what if the person reached out another way? No, she didn't take his tablet. The Popo got his fucking tablet, but I guess she must have forgot that. Malachi would never forgive himself if something happened to his son. He would have to table the idea for this trip. His phone buzzed with a call from his mother. Hey, Ma. Hi, Malachi. How are you feeling? His mother's voice always comforted him when she wasn't getting on his nerves and nagging him about one thing or another. I'm just taking it day by day. Good. That's all you can do. I talked to your father's insurance company as well as the funeral home. There wasn't much money, so we're going to have to go with one of the less expensive caskets. Malachi felt anxiety rising up within him. This was the second time in a matter of days a panic attack tried to overtake him. He couldn't have this kind of conversation right now. He tried to keep it short. Are the less expensive ones bad looking? Alice paused. Well, they're not anything I would want to be buried in, but I'm making sure my policy covers the entire cost of my funeral when the time comes. Malachi could sense that his mother was about to start going in about his father. He couldn't take that right now. The man was dead and gone. He could barely wrap his mind around that thought. He just couldn't do it. Ma, can we talk about this tomorrow? I'm really not in the right frame of mind right now. Alice switched to a comforting tone again. I know, honey, but we need to move quickly on this. Then just do what you feel is best, okay? He hadn't meant to snap at her. She was only trying to help, but he couldn't help it. His mother would never understand. Alice was silent for a few moments before she spoke again. Okay, Malachi, I'll handle everything. Talk to you later. She hung up and Malachi felt like scum. You feel like what you are, you fucking piece of shit. Mm. His mother was the one who stuck in there with him while he was growing up, taking care of shit she never should have had to do by herself. Marcus ran the streets and shirked his responsibilities, not Alice. Alice broke up back for her son. Malachi's thumb hovered over the button to call his mother back, but he changed his mind and texted her instead. Sorry for snapping, Ma. I appreciate you for everything you're doing. She wrote back a few moments later. Malachi, I'm not angry with you. Love you, baby. Oh, man, fuck that shit. I'd have been like, you know what? I thought about it. Fuck you. Figure it out. Bye-bye. Yeah. You'd be snapping on me. Because why the fuck you got so much emotion for a nigga you don't even fucking know? Like, you don't know this nigga, man. Fuck is you doing? Oh, you all swole up in your fucking chest about it. You busted up over a nigga that didn't give a fuck about you. Conehead bastard. I swear, I can't stand a dumbass man. Ugh, a dumbass man. He used to be like, man, fuck it. He dumb. Yeah. That's how I don't see how people be falling for. Hey, yo, shawty, what your name is? Shit. Candyman, that's my fucking name. But you gotta say it four times because I'm a little hard of hearing. Ah, shit, stupid bastard. Oh, man, I know it's three times, but, you know, on phonem, I gotta say that. All right, here we go. here we go. Y'all, Chapter 21, Malachi didn't feel like he had anything better to do with himself, so he began to roam. He wasn't going anywhere in particular at first, but his travels led him to the local mall. He sat in the parking lot for a few minutes, contemplating his next move. Should I go in here? Why would I? He asked himself. He thought about it a little further, then realized it might make sense to at least see if they had something he could wear for Marcus's funeral. He sighed and got out of his car, clicking his key fob and moping toward the doors. Nigga, put on a nice pair of black slacks and a white shirt and a black tie so you look like a fucking usher. Usher that nigga to hell. That's what the fuck. Hell, you ain't get no damn suit for this nigga. Hell, he ain't even get you a fucking Tonka truck for your goddamn Christmas or your birthday. He wandered from store to store, forgetting every couple of minutes why he was at the mall, then remembering after he left each location. My mind is a freaking mess, he muttered, then almost tripped over his feet. Some kids who were walking by from the opposite direction burst out laughing, and it caused Malachi to crack a smile. He remembered when he was that age, not a care in the world, except about his father and why he'd never chosen him over his extracurricular activities. Don't forget his other fucking kids. Don't forget that. His smile faltered, and Malachi continued his half-hearted pursuit. Hey, a familiar female voice said. Malachi looked. It was Leah. He was at a loss for words. The woman was fine, with her hair flowing down to her waist, her big almond-colored eyes and heart-shaped lips looking ready to kiss. There was something about Leah that drew Malachi in every time. He barely knew her, yet every time they encountered one another, he was longing for more. Malachi, Leah said, waving her hand in front of his face. Hey, he finally answered. He took in the sight of her collarbone, which was showing underneath the crisp white tank top she was wearing. She had on some light blue distressed jeans and white peep-toe pumps. Something about peep-toe pumps always made Malachi brick up. It didn't matter who was wearing them, but Leah was wearing them well. Are you okay? She asked, looking at him with concern now. He snapped out of it yet again. Oh, yeah, I'm good. I'm sorry for spacing. Now, how have you been? Leah smirked. Well, besides missing you and waiting for your call, I've been good. He blushed. Missing me, huh? Well, I've missed you too. He meant those words, but guilt still began to creep up within him. He was finally making progress in the relationship department with Zoe by letting go of Shartasia, but he did all that just to keep talking to Leah? What was wrong with him? Leah played with her hair. Oh, so you missed me, huh? Not enough to call, though. Malachi licked his lips. I definitely meant to. It's just, he paused. Reality slapped him in the face. My father just died, he blurted out, more to himself than to Leah. She gasped, her eyes widening. Oh my God, are you okay? She reached out and touched his arm, then pulled him in for a hug. Malachi couldn't help but inhale her airy scent. What the hell is it about this woman? She got me open like a motherfucker. Leah pulled back from the hug. Are you okay? She repeated. Malachi looked down into her eyes. Not really. I just been drifting ever since it happened. They were silent for a few moments. She looked like she really felt bad for him. How did it happen, if you don't mind me asking? Malachi swallowed. Cancer, he said, then looked away. Damn, she breathed. Well, do you want to go somewhere and talk about it? Malachi paused. Well, actually, he stopped himself. He was just about to say that he had something to tell her, that he had a woman and that he was sorry for leading her on, but he stopped himself. He had no idea why, but instead of turning Leah down, his next words were, actually, I was planning on going out of town in a couple of weeks. I want a trip to Jamaica from my job. Would you be interested in going? Leah looked confused. Jamaica? Malachi quickly clarified. Yeah, this whole situation makes me want to get away. I would go by myself, but since you and I haven't really had a lot of time to get to know each other with my busy schedule and all, he felt like punching himself in the face as he saw Leia's eyes light up. His phone buzzed in his pocket with a phone call, but he ignored it. Sure, I mean, yeah, I've never been to Jamaica. Are you sure it isn't too soon, though? Leia looked torn. Malachi eased her anxiety. Nah, I think it would be good. We'll have nothing but space and time to talk. A smile played at the corners of her lips, and Malachi's phone buzzed in his pocket again with another call, but he still ignored it. Okay, it's a deal, Leia finally agreed. Hit me up tonight with the details. Bet, he said, and gave her another hug before they parted ways. Malachi had more of a pep in his step as he went to a store, picked out something to wear to Marcus's funeral. As he exited the mall, however, his guilt returned. He had some serious work to do if he was ever going to change his ways with women. His phone buzzed in his pocket yet again with a text, and he finally answered it. It was Ben asking how he was doing. He shot his friend a quick reply, then noticed that the random number who was calling him left a voicemail. He hesitated before clicking it to see who it was, hoping it wasn't that damn Avenger. Then he sucked his teeth and clicked play. His heart plummeted to his shoes when he heard the message. It was Aaron. Her voice sounded shaky, which put him on alert. Hey, Malachi, it's me. I don't have much time, but I wanted to... Malachi, I... Oh, shit! The phone hung up. Malachi immediately grew frantic. What happened to Aaron? He called the number back and found out it was a payphone. A payphone? He wrinkled his nose. Shit, hold on. Okay. Malachi drove by Aaron's house. But, of course, neither her nor Banks's cars were outside. I bet you they done moved. He knocked on the door and peeked in the windows, too, but the lights were off. He drove by her job next, then her mother's house as a last resort. Malachi! Sandy, Aaron's mother, greeted him. They shared a hug. Hey, Miss Sandy, how are you? She assessed him with her eyes. I'm good. What's wrong with you? What brings you here? Malachi shifted in his stance. Well, I was trying to find Aaron. Sandy's expression darkened. Oh, really? Yeah. Do you know where she is? Sandy took a step back. No, I don't. This was getting weird. Are you sure? She just called me, but I wasn't able to reach her back. Sandy huffed. Oh, so she called you, huh? But when I call, do you have her number? She called me from a payphone. Sandy's eyes widened. Malachi wasn't sure how much Sandy knew about her daughter's relationship with Banks, but it didn't look like she knew much. No, I don't, she said again. You don't? Malachi was confused. Sandy clarified. The last time I called my daughter, the line was disconnected. I tried to go to her house and she ushered me out the door. That man she's with. Malachi, that man is nothing like you. I don't know why you and Aaron broke up. I loved you two as a couple. You need to get her back because that Banks character, he's no good. Who the hell names themselves after a building? Young people these days. Sandy continued her rant, but Malachi was lost in thought. Aaron and her mother were extremely close, but Aaron never told her why they broke up. And she didn't know what was going on with Aaron and Banks. That nigga was isolating her from her family. Who knew what he would do next? Malachi had to find her. Now, he more determined to find this bitch than he is to be a father to his son or a good nigga for his bitch, Zoe. He wanted to kick himself for letting her slip from his memory yet again. That's what happens when your priorities are out of whack, his conscience reminded him. Miss Sandy, please let me know if she contacts you again, okay? He said, then hurried out the door before Aaron's mother could say another word. Oh, God. And then there's a break in the chapter. As my resolve is about to break with this fucking book. He ain't doing too much maintenance, though. But like I told y'all, this is more like the mystery type of thing. All right. The Avenger stared carefully at each photo of Leia, trying to select the perfect one. Malachi thought he was so slick, so smooth. It was time to up the ante. They finally chose the right picture, then sent it to Malachi's phone with a caption, "Think this is a game? Think again." After sending the text, they waited. And of course, Malachi tried to call. They didn't answer because it was no time for covers to be blown just yet. That time would come later. Malachi responded with a text, "Fuck you." Tisk, tisk, they said, then sent a message back. Cute. Then they destroyed the burner phone and picked up a new one from the pile. Damn, who is tormenting this nigga? And that's the end of that chapter. Yeah, I don't know. Erin is a slow bopper because she's staying with that Banks nigga. And this is how she spells her name. Yeah, that's how she spell it. But I feel like, All right. I want to know. I wanted to get to the halfway point. Because it's 49 chapters and an epilogue. So technically that's 50 chapters. So I at least wanted to get through 25 of them. But I don't know, y'all. Because I'm kind of hungry. Not hungry. Hungry. Yeah. I ain't had shit but fucking grapefruit, water, and coffee. So, yeah. I need to eat. Let me see. Hold on. Hold on, y'all. Okay. All right. Thank y'all for waiting. All right. So I'm going to give y'all to chapter 25 and then I got to go. All right. Let me see. I'm sitting here trying to think, do I need to go potty first? I don't know, y'all. I don't think so. I'm good. All right, let me get this next. I'm so damn nosy. But I like the idea of getting through half the book today. Then we finish up tomorrow, right? Yeah, sounds like a plan, eh? Very good. That's what I'm talking about. I would like to finish this in the morrow. Chapter 22. Today was Marcus's funeral. Malachi forced his eyes open. He didn't want to get up and go. He didn't feel like greeting all those people, putting on a smiley face and enduring all of the sorry for your losses. He reached over for Zoe, but her side of the bed was empty. His eyes popped open and he turned his head so fast he got a crick in his neck. What the? Malachi bounded out of bed. She could not be doing this again. Zoe's ass had been really absent-minded lately. He went over to the window and saw that her car was gone. She really went to work? Malachi couldn't believe it. No way she forgot about him. No way she forgot today was his father's funeral. He got that he'd been distant with her and rejected most of her attempts to comfort him, but still, how could she miss something like this? Anger coursed through his veins. He stormed into the bathroom and ripped back the shower curtain, seeing that the inside of the tub was still wet from when Zoe must have showered earlier. He turned on the water, stripped off his clothes, and stepped inside. He let the hot water rain down on his body. The tears tried to overtake him, but he hadn't shed one since Marcus passed and didn't plan to anytime soon. His breathing grew labored as his anxiety increased. He was not going back there today. He had overcome his attacks as a teen, forced himself to calm down before they grew too strong. It seemed that he was growing weaker with time. You need some medication, dummy. Malachi knew it was all the issues that were burdening him lately. The fact that he pretty much wasn't shit. All the women in his life, his father, his son, it was all too much. He stared at the cord to Zoe's blow dryer, which was hanging near the bathroom mirror on the wall. He could see it through the opening in the curtain. All he had to do was plug it in. Malachi swallowed. He couldn't go out now. He had too much to live for. Makai needed a father. He didn't want to live for himself, but he owed it to his son to at least put forth an effort. Your son, you're just starting to take an interest in? There his mind was again, pummeling him. Malachi reached for his soap on a rope, chuckling as he thought of all the many arguments he and Zoe had gotten into about this thing. Oh my God, that's so unsanitary, she told him. Woman, you ain't never complained about my cleanliness, he shot back. Malachi lathered his body with the soap, then began to wash himself with a washcloth. That was one thing that he'd allowed Zoe to win on. She insisted that he use two washcloths for the shower, or more specifically, a face cloth and a washcloth. Malachi didn't see much of a difference between the two, but he listened to his woman for a change. But he didn't listen when she told him to keep his dick in his pants. He shook his head, still pissed at her. After finishing his shower, Malachi took his time getting dressed and ready. His phone had been ringing like crazy. He figured it must be Zoe apologizing for flaking out and going to work. He expected her to walk in the door any minute. He sprayed some cologne and checked himself out in Zoe's full-length mirror. He looked sharp, though he wished it was for a different occasion. Try as he might to shake the feeling, Malachi felt like there was a hole in his heart. Marcus hadn't played a strong role in his life growing up, but the fact that there was no chance for it to happen now deeply disturbed him. He forced himself once again from his morbid thought process and headed to his car. When he got inside, he finally checked his messages. He had two from Leia, surprisingly. He'd texted her about the trip to Jamaica the other night, and she seemed excited, but he hadn't expected her to remember his father's funeral. Shartasia had texted him as well, telling him to stay strong. Ben asked if he wanted a ride, and Zaire had said he was on his way to the funeral home. No texts from Zoe, no calls either. That pissed Malachi off even further. How did everybody else remember except her? She was so caught up in that damn job that she couldn't be here for her man. Maybe that's why I'm... He stopped himself before finishing that sentence. He could blame Zoe all he wanted, but there was no way he could blame her for his indiscretions. That was all on him. He'd been that way long before he met her, and from the looks of it, he still hadn't learned his lesson now. And there's a break in the chapter because this dude is a dummy. Oh, okay. Okay. Malachi pulled up to the funeral home, sucking his teeth at all the cars that were already parked outside. All these people knew his father, and most of them probably knew him better than his own son. Malachi wondered if any of his half-brothers or sisters were coming, or their mothers. Oh, shit, he said, hoping their mothers didn't come, or if they did, that there wouldn't be any drama between them and Alice. What had happened long ago, but sometimes wounds like that ran deep and never fully healed. Child, listen. Unless they some fucking bird-ass bitches. But at this point now, their kids are just as grown as your rusty black ass. I don't think they really give a fuck no more. Malachi should know. He sighed and got out of the car, figuring he might as well get this shit over with. When he walked inside, he kept his tunnel vision and headed to the front pew as Alice instructed. She was already up there along with Ben and Zaire. Malachi was grateful for the support. He nodded at Shartasia, who was in the pew behind them, along with Makai. Malachi couldn't help but to smile with pride at how sharp his son looked in his little suit. It brought a tear to his eyes. How would Makai feel at his funeral one day? He blinked back the tear, then faced forward. A few seconds later, his son walked over and slid in the seat next to him, grabbing Malachi's huge hand in his tiny one. "It's okay, Daddy," Makai said. "I'm right here." That broke him down. Before he knew it, Malachi was bent over the pew, overcome with emotion. "Lord Jesus," Alice said, fanning him and standing in front of her son. Ben and Zaire were at his sides, their hands on his shoulders, and even Shartasia had walked over, trying to give him encouraging words. "It's gonna be okay, Malachi," she was saying. He couldn't answer. All he had were fragmented memories swimming through his mind, memories that would never get the chance to be completed because his father was gone. He stayed in that position for a while, then finally allowed his friends to sit him back up in his seat. Then he looked over at Marcus in the casket and almost lost it again. "Why, God, why?" he prayed in his mind. "Why didn't we get a chance?" The ceremony began shortly after that. All of the words and messages and songs went by like a blur. Malachi barely paid attention. Toward the end, he felt someone staring at him, so he looked a few pews back and locked eyes with Aaron. Malachi gasped. He hadn't expected to see her here. From the looks of it, she was just walking in. She looked nervous, but Malachi's heart filled with butterflies at her beauty. She was wearing a simple black dress, but it accentuated her toned and curvy body. She gave him a small half smile, and Malachi was about to get up to go talk to her, but he realized he couldn't quite do that right now, seeing that the ceremony was still going forth. He shot her a wave instead, and she waved back. He wondered how Aaron knew about the funeral. Then he remembered that Alice had put the obituary in the paper and on the internet. Finally, the ceremony ended. Malachi wanted to make a beeline for Aaron as soon as it was over. He caught her eye again and was walking toward her when her attention shifted. She immediately tensed and started looking anxious. Malachi followed her gaze and saw that Banks had entered the building. Malachi stalked over. How dare he show up to his father's funeral? That was the ultimate disrespect. Ben and Zaire must have sensed that something was brewing because they got up to Banks and his boys the same time Malachi did. "Trash man, we meet again," Banks smirked. "My condolences for your loss." "What are you doing here?" Malachi said. "Get the hell out." "I surely will, with my woman." Malachi moved to hook off on him. But Ben stopped him. "Come on, man. Now, not the time or the place." Banks eyed Ben. "Good call." He roughly grabbed Aaron by her arm and they walked out of the building. Malachi wanted to kill him. Zaire looked like he was trying to put two and two together. "Man, what the hell is going on there?" Malachi didn't bother to answer. And that's the end of that chapter. All right. What y'all talking about? I'm so fucking nosy. Yo, what the fuck? I know you lying. Girl, what is going on? I mean, you ain't gotta I know what was going on, but what is going on? Girl, you know what to do. Because, no God. All right, let me hurry the fuck up. All right, let me see. Okay. Ciao. Yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, what is happening right now? Chapter 23. Zoe rushed up to the gravesite looking flustered. "Oh my God, Malachi, I'm so sorry. I completely forgot." She touched his arm, but Malachi completely ignored her. He wasn't in any mood to talk to her right now. This day was shit. Nothing could change that. Malachi stood there and listened to the preacher say his final words. Then a woman from the church sang another song. After that, people started laying flowers on the casket. Malachi didn't move. Alice was standing in front of him, asking if he wanted to stay all the way till the end or go to the repast now. Malachi didn't respond, so Zoe cut in. "Can you have someone take his car? I'll drive him." Somehow, she had gotten his keys. Malachi was grateful because he didn't feel like he was in any shape to drive. He still wasn't in any mood to talk either, though. His mind was on Aaron. She had come to the funeral, which must have been a huge risk for her. Then he had just let Banks take her. Why didn't he do more to stop him? Yes, Banks and his boys had guns, but Malachi. Zoe waved her hand in front of his face. Malachi had barely noticed that most of the crowd was gone now. He followed Zoe to her car and got in the passenger seat. "Baby, I'm so sorry," she tried, apologizing again. "It's fine." "No, it's not. By the time I realized what day it was, I had already started my shift. I couldn't get anyone to relieve me right away or I would have been here sooner. Malachi, please forgive me." "You're forgiven." His tone was cold and robotic. Zoe chose not to say anything else for the rest of the ride. They got to the repast, which was held at one of the local banquet halls. There was plenty of good food, but Malachi wasn't hungry. Zoe filled his plate anyway and tried to force him to eat and drink. He took a few bites to appease her, but he really just wanted to leave. His half-brothers and sisters did show up, but their mothers didn't. Malachi shared a few words with them before they left, but none of them had much to say to each other. They hadn't spoken in all these years. Malachi reasoned that there was no point in starting now. When they got home, he wanted nothing more than to go to sleep. Zaire and Ben had dropped off his car and left the keys in the mailbox. Malachi grabbed them and followed Zoe into their apartment. "Can I get you anything?" she asked after kicking off her shoes. "Nope." Zoe stared at him. "Malachi, you can talk to me." He broke his daze and looked at her. "Okay, you want to talk? How could you forget my father's funeral?" She started stuttering. "I know it's no excuse. You really just went to work. That's what." Zoe paused. "Listen, maybe we should continue this conversation later." "Oh, now you want to switch it, huh?" "That's it," she said, her tone sharp. "I'm tired of you treating me like shit. It's not my fault your father died. I've been trying to be here for you every step of the way, but I make one mistake and you act like this? Fuck you, Malachi. And for the record, you told me you and your father weren't even that close anyway." With those words, she stalked upstairs and slammed their bedroom door. Malachi didn't bother to follow her. His whole life was a mess. He needed to get away. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, if Zoe know what's good for her, she'll pack her grip and take a trip. Get the fuck up out of Dodge. Child, mm-mm. Oh, okay. Well, what you ain't got the flu or nothing, is you? Child, listen. All right, let me All right, I got my time stamp. So, 5 seconds. Chapter 24. The next morning, Malachi sincerely apologized to Zoe and she accepted. They hung tight for a few days, then she was back to work. Since Malachi's bereavement was over too, he figured he would go back to work himself. He still planned to go to Jamaica, but he held off, contemplating whether he should call off the idea of going with Leah. "Well, I think you should, dumbass. That's a no-brainer." Fucking dummy. Anyway, then he decided to just do it. This would be one last time and his one chance to see what Leo was all about. He figured since he'd strung her along so far up to this point, this trip was a way to make it up to her. He would take her out and let her have the time of her life, but he wouldn't even attempt to sleep with her. This was going to be strictly platonic. Leah was a nice girl. He didn't want to do her like that. He texted her and told her it was on in a week. She texted back and told him she couldn't wait. Then he deleted their thread. This was his pattern for the next few nights. Text back and forth with Leah about the trip, then delete the thread. He told Zoe he had a sanitation convention that weekend, so he would be out of town. She didn't bat an eye because he went on these types of trips several times a year. He tried to get her to go with him a few times, and she had gone once, but every time after that, she'd make excuses about having to work, so Malachi stopped trying. If Zoe wasn't anything, she was driven to prove herself to parents who really didn't seem to give a damn about her accomplishments either way. If Zoe wasn't following their plans for her life, they would never be pleased. Malachi definitely understood where Zoe was coming from, trying to open their eyes about her ambition, but he hoped that when they closed on this house, her feelings wouldn't hurt too bad from the apathy she would surely receive from Xander and Zelda. Today was a day spent mostly outside at various dumps, so Malachi was sweating and stinking something serious. Thankfully, the company had a locker and shower room that employees could use at the end of their shifts. Malachi entered the shower room and no other guys were in there. Thank God, he breathed. Not that he minded, but he didn't want to hear any more condolences about his father. He was trying to stop thinking about Marcus, not dwell on him. He stepped into the shower and turned it on, lathering up his body and humming as the stench was washing away. He was at it for a few moments before he swore he heard someone humming with him. He stopped immediately. Silence. Then he heard a sound like someone was moving around in the room. "Hey, yo, who that?" he said in a joking voice. Then all the lights turned off. What the? Malachi couldn't see anything in front of him. The room was pitch dark. He felt around for the knob and turned off the shower. "Yo," he called out again. He heard a light chuckle. Then the door to the room quickly opened and shut. The person locked it behind them. "What the hell, man? Why they playing like this?" Malachi started getting scared. He walked out of the stall and tried to make his way to where he thought the door might be. He turned a corner and slipped and almost busted his ass. There was something slippery on the ground like oil. "Shit," he said under his breath, and that was when he smelled the smoke. "Shit," he repeated. It looked like whoever had locked him in the room had set fire to something in the trash can. Malachi could make out the faint glow of the flames from across the room. He tried to walk toward the trash can, but slipped again, and this time he did bust his ass. "Somebody help!" he yelled out. Then the fire alarm went off. The sprinklers rained down all over him, drenching him yet again. Malachi stood just as he heard people walking by the shower room to get out of the building. "Hey, yo, I'm locked in the shower room," he yelled, then got up and slowly made his way toward the door again. Thankfully, someone heard him and unlocked the door. Pedro, one of his co-workers, was the one who unlocked it. He flipped on the light, then looked disgusted. "Hey, man, you, get dressed." Malachi had forgotten he was naked. Filled with embarrassment, he slipped and slid to his stall to grab his towel, but unfortunately, it appeared his clothes were stolen from his locker. He already knew who was behind this. That Avenger motherfucker had it coming. Y'all listen. What the fuck? Why in the hell? Who is this person, yo? Anyway, all right, let me, I am so goddamn nosy, yo. Ooh, if only I could have started earlier, we, probably would have finished this thing today, but, yeah, that ain't gonna happen now. All right. Fuck. I'm not doing that. Nope. I just looked at how much time was left. Nope, not doing it. I'm hungry. So hungry, I got a fucking headache, yo. Mm-mm. All right, so here we go, y'all. Few more seconds. Mm-mm-mm. Okay. Chapter 25. Tonight was the night. Malachi and Leia were flying out. Malachi had the whole trip planned. Leia was going to have a blast. He'd already resolved in his mind that this was their last time seeing each other. He wasn't going to sleep with her, and he was going to let her down gently after the trip was over. He thought about it all day at work. His mind went back and forth over whether it was a good idea to go through with this. What if his plans backfired? What if he messed around and slept with her anyway? Why did he feel the need to take her on a trip to prove he wasn't a dirtbag? What if she still hated him afterward? All the questions weighed down on him to the point where he almost said, fuck it, and canceled. If he did, he reasoned, that might be even more fucked up than going. Why get the woman's hopes up just to let her down? Fuck it, it's settled, he said to himself, then focused on other things for the rest of his shift. He ran a few errands before it was time to go to Leia's house to pick her up. They planned to catch a flight to a hotel and spend the night, then catch another flight in the morning, heading for Jamaica. Malachi allowed himself to get excited about the trip. He had never been to Jamaica either, so he hoped it was as fun as he thought it would be. Finally, the time had come. Malachi was set to pick up Leia at 8 o'clock to catch a 10 o'clock flight. She didn't live far from the airport. He shot her a text to let her know he was on his way. She didn't respond, but Malachi figured she must have been rushing to get ready. They texted each other that morning, and Leia said she would be waiting for him, so he wasn't too worried. Malachi pulled up to her address. It was a nice neighborhood, quiet looking and well kept. He saw Leia's blue convertible parked in front of her place. He couldn't wait to see her. He checked his breath, then made his way up to her front door. Once he got there, he stopped short. Something was wrong. Her front door was ajar, but her house was silent. A creepy feeling overcame Malachi, but he did something stupid anyway. He made a fist and slowly pushed the door open with his knuckles. Leia was laying on the kitchen floor in a pool of blood, with a gunshot wound to her head and her phone laying beside her. Shit, Malachi hissed. This was wrong. This was all wrong. What the fuck happened? Who had done this? He whipped out his phone to call the police, but stopped when his thumb hit the third digit. What was he doing here? How the hell was he going to explain his presence to the police? Not to mention Zoe. There was no other option. Malachi knew what he had to do. He fought back his emotions as he carefully stepped into the kitchen, then knelt down to pick up Leia's phone. He went to her text messages, call log, and contacts and deleted all traces of himself from her device. Then he grabbed a dish towel and wiped down the phone, then the floor where he stepped, then the doorknob and door as he left it ajar as it had previously been. His heart pounded as he sent up a quick prayer that God would not allow him to get caught up in this as a suspect. Then he darted off towards his car. He stopped by a random gas station on the way to the airport and ditched the dish towel in the trash receptacle. Then he went to the airport to catch his flight, praying he'd made the right decision. Damn. I know. Right, yo. Oh my God. Child, listen. And it be cliffhanger time. This next chapter is 5 minutes, but it's only 2 minutes till it's 9 o'clock. So it's okay. I hope she don't have no Ring camera buns, because child, listen, okay. Now, this time, the Avenger is playing for keeps, y'all. They said they didn't come to play with you hoes. Right. So, that's that, child. Oh, Lord, have mercy. So, I don't, and hell nope. All right, y'all. I am getting ready to get the hell out of here. Sorry, I had to let somebody in over there on Instagram. Okay. All right. So I am going to bid you guys a good goddamn night. Yes, indeed, indeed. Thank y'all for listening to me read out loud, and I hope I left y'all feeling better than you were. I can't even damn talk. I'm so excited. Than you were when you got here. All right. Y'all have a good night. Wifey, you know what to do. And listen, y'all. If you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all.